Brilliant, thanks so much. Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. We have apologies today from Michael Mara and Ross Greer. The first item on our agenda this morning is to hear evidence on the Disabled Children and Young People Transitions to Adulthood Scotland Bill. And we have two panels of witnesses joining us today, all of whom are appearing virtually. Can I welcome our first panel of witnesses? We have Leanne McCauley, head teacher from New Struan School, representing Scottish Autism. Andy Miller, the strategic lead, participation and practice lead, Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities. Jenny Miller, chief executive, PAMIS, representing the Alliance. And Rebecca Scarlett, senior policy and information officer from Lead Scotland. We have a lot of ground to cover today, so we will move straight to questions. And you can either put your hand up if you want to come in on the specific. The members will probably direct a question to you, but you can either make note in the chat function or put your hand up and we'll come to you. I can see you quite clearly. So can I move straight to questions from my colleague Ruth Maguire, please? Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'd like to ask some questions about transitions into adult services. The committee heard from young people and from parents last week and this week. So we've heard about some issues with consistency and the different experiences that children and young people will have. Can I start by asking you what the key barriers are to supporting better outcomes as disabled children and young people move into adult services, whether that's from school to college or in terms of health service? I have forgotten my glasses, so it's quite okay. Can I go to Leanne McCauley first, please?
Hello, good morning. Some of the key barriers that the young people that I work with face are that there really is not the availability of services for them to move on to, meaning that they can't move on at the right time for them. It's often quite an arbitrary point of transition, the school leaving age of 18. Transition planning starts far too late for most young people. The current guidance suggests that we should be starting at 16. However, it's only 6 months before a young person's due to move on that then becomes mandatory, which has a real knock-on impact for our young people, particularly around relationships, because if you're going to work with somebody to build the right option for them moving forwards, you need to know and understand them. I think a lot of our young people and their families feel they're not heard, they don't have a voice in these transitions, that there are, rather than a suite of options available to them as there would be for other young people approaching school leaving age, that it's more about what's available and what's affordable than it is about what should be in place for a young person.
Thank you.
Leanne, I think those are really the key points.
Okay, great, thank you. When you speak about availability of services, can you just give me a bit more on that? Is that they're not the services that the young people want? You spoke there about them not having the same choices as some other children and young people. I'm also interested in the point you raised there about guidance being that the planning should start at 16, but you said it only actually starts 6 months before they go. Can you talk a bit more about that as well, please?
Certainly. So when I talk about there not being the right services and options, the young people that I work with, a lot of them live with us as well. They're placed with us residentially. And there is a real lack of availability of suitable adult services, particularly specialist services that can provide for the care needs of the young people I work with. And geographically, that's a very patchy picture. There are not always services close to a young person's home and their own community, meaning that young people face losing all of their support network, being moved, and that's not necessarily closer to home and closer to their family and their support networks. Partly that's a staffing crisis that's well publicised in social care, that there are not the availability of staff to enable us to deliver services. For young people transitioning into adulthood, there is a lack of suitable homes for them to move to, in the case of our residential young people. And there's no overarching strategic plan. We know who these young people are from a very young age, in a lot of cases, and there doesn't appear to be. It's when we get young people to 17, 18 years old that there's then, oh goodness me, what we're going to be able to find for them. So I feel that really limits their choices.
Okay, thank you. I know colleagues will want to drill in further to some of these things that you brought up, but I'm just going to stay on these first questions with the rest of the panel about the key barriers and some of that inconsistency for our young our children and young people. Could I come to Jenny Miller next, please?
Yes, thank you very much. I would agree with everything that Leanne has said. That is, it's completely across the country as well. And one of the big issues that we're finding at the moment is that there is actually no adult social worker to step in and support the transition. So we have a group of young people in a project that we manage on transitions where we use a PAMIS digital passport and we have a support worker, but actually not one of those young people who are leaving school in the summer has a social worker yet. And I would also echo that there just aren't the services to go. I work with children, young people and adults who have profound learning and multiple disabilities and their families. And I'm very sorry about the dog in the background. And they are really, they're really struggling to find the right appropriate services. And unfortunately, our group do need a building-based service because they need access to changing place toilets. They need somewhere to go when they perhaps don't feel well enough to be out and about, and some of them have rare syndromes that mean that actually, you know, meeting out in large places just isn't suitable, and there just isn't the support or the suitability there. And one other real gap and issue and barrier is actually moving into adult health services. And I know that a lot of colleagues from other charities and we are very concerned that there's no one single person that helps take them across there. Some really interesting research by Michael Brown that just highlighted the whole issues for families who feel that they're left doing the transition themselves, that they're isolated, that it's uncoordinated, that they lose that wrapped around support and service, and they face sort of multiple appointments with multiple consultants. So it's messy and terrifying, actually, place out there at the moment. And I think particularly with the lack of coordinated plans. We would recommend, and I'm sure that actually those transitions for complex children need to start much earlier. They should start at 14. But as Leanne said, some of them aren't starting until 6 months before they go, if that.
Thank you. Your points there about the transitions into adult health reflects what we were told by parents that we listened to on Monday night. Yes, Monday night. Thank you. Can I ask the same question of the other panel members? Maybe come to Rebecca, please.
Yep, certainly. Good morning. So I work for Leeds Scotland and we run a National Disabled Students Helpline. So I'm very much talking from an education perspective here. I really just echo what the rest of the panel has said so far about the lack of appropriate provision and services for young people. And we find that's especially for young people with profound and complex needs. Another key issue that comes up a lot for us on Helpline from parents is talking about actually the lack of funding that's available for young people who actually are moving into the provision that's available, but they need social care support to get there. We're often finding that young people, perhaps who are autistic or have mental health problems, who are moving into mainstream provision, can often lack or find it difficult to get the right funding. What can sometimes happen, we find, is a college might say, OK, you've got a place on this course, but actually you can't attend the course unless you can travel independently or unless you have support and funding to come. But actually, social services are in crisis. They're only funding cases that are emergencies. So the criteria is very high, and these young people are not getting access to the support that they need. So they're really left in limbo. In terms of the lack of provision, that really is something that is so stark that comes through on the helpline is from parents of young people who are perhaps moving on from special schools. They're often really shocked and indignant that actually there isn't a service. Where's the specialist education for my young person? Where's the equality here? There's one specialist college funded in Scotland, brand new, just opened last year, run by Capability Scotland. And that compares to about 120 in England. So parents calling our helpline and want to know what are the options, what are the services, and what's being offered to them is often social services that are not appropriate. These parents are telling us our young people need to continue learning, they need to develop their skills. Specialist colleges in England, they deliver qualifications, they might focus on English and maths, as well as looking at the kind of holistic overview of their well-being. We have a guarantee policy agenda, no one left behind, young person's guarantee, but actually this particular group are being failed. They absolutely are being left behind. And these young people do not have the choices that their colleagues, their peers do when it comes to moving on from school.
Thank you. And if I can ask Andy the same question there, please.
Yeah, I'm going to agree with the three that have already just given evidence about lack of options, lack of services, and how consistently poor the picture is across most of the country. There are exceptions, and we can talk about them, but generally it's a poor picture. One of the biggest things that's a problem for young people and families, and they probably mentioned it in their session, was it's just that everything changes when at this time of leaving school, and nothing's easy. And so that feeling of everything being hard is complicated by the lack of support that is then offered to people to navigate that. And a lack of information is one of the big problems. So people that we spoke to cited finding out far too late that there would be a charge for their social care support, which they never had to pay for children's services. Finding out that certain health services, physiotherapy, would no longer be available. And all of this information gathering seems to be left to the families. One of the biggest differences that I think is so problematic is the change to a social care system that's based on eligibility criteria, because that requires an assessment from social work. And as Jenny mentioned, that is often just not available. And so we've heard from young people who've not left school when they wanted to leave and done another year in school just because they couldn't leave. There was no support for them to leave and carry on with any kind of life that they wanted to lead. And so it does have a big impact. And I think that's a kind of, it's going to be a recurring theme, I think, in this, the lack of staffing, the lack of support, the lack of services.
I've got a small sup on that specific thing from Graham. Okay. It's coming at the end. Okay, thank you.
So it's challenging online. So you spoke there about the threshold being higher for services, about the actual lack of services themselves, and the challenges around options. We've also heard about inconsistency in support across the country. Can the panel say what they think causes that inconsistency?
Maybe again. Who would like to go first? Rebecca?
Yeah, sure. I think we've kind of touched on it already, but often it can come down to, in terms of services, it's about a bit of a postcode lottery and what's available. So that's kind of where that inconsistency lies in terms of what options there are for young people. I think that it's also about resourcing and capacity and training for services and what their approaches are, and if there's strategic buy-in from the top, and how transitions are being delivered and picked up.
Oh, thank you, Rebecca. Does anyone else want to come in on that? I'm looking for a...
I appreciate that you covered quite a lot of this, so but if you wish to add anything.
Andy and Jenny both had their hand up. Yes, on our... So we'll go to Jenny first and then Andy. Are they putting that in?
Yeah, I guess that the other thing is how well that multidisciplinary team works. I think where there is a real team approach and where children and adult services do talk together, and I'm really sorry, but I think sometimes that comes down to personalities. I think that causes the inconsistency. And I think one of the other bits absolutely echoing is about training. And, you know, doing an assessment on somebody with very complex needs requires somebody with a whole range of skills, because the questions that you ask need deeper understanding. And I think it depends on the level of staff that are probably doing those assessments. But a lot of it is about whether you have good teams in action.
So, Jenny, can I just ask, so personalities, training, leadership, a lot of that's about culture rather than about legislation or guidance even. How would you reflect on that?
I would totally agree. And my big worry is that if you put legislation in and there isn't a will and a culture to take it forward, you know, what will happen? That there has to be a real will and to make sure, embrace everybody's human rights. And personally, I find that the group that we support are often the ones that are left behind and forgotten and invisible, and never more so during COVID. Our services haven't come back. There are no day services for people to move on to. So, you know, there has to be a will. There has to be a culture change. Yeah, absolutely, Ruth.
OK, thank you.
Come in.
Yeah, Andy.
As well. And Leanne, they all do. Andy first. Thank you.
I think one of the reasons for inconsistency is to do with how local authorities or health and social care partnerships choose to deploy their resources. And one of the main factors for transitions here is that some areas recruit a dedicated transitions worker, and that does seem to make a significant difference. So there's places like Falkirk, for example, and South Ayrshire, and I'm sure there are more, where they have dedicated transitions workers. They have a role to coordinate the planning and to bridge that gap between children's and adults' services. And it seems to be a good model. I'm not sure what the evidence base is for it, but anecdotally, that seems to make a big difference.
We certainly heard from parents that we spoke to that the transitions officer in Falkirk was a Wonder Woman by all accounts. So I think that's assisting. Was anyone else wanting to come in on that?
You've covered his points.
Oh, right. Okay.
Oh, Leanne, sorry, I thought you meant on... Yeah. I'm going to apologise on the record, because this is the first virtual meeting we've done for a while, and I've not quite got into the swing of it. So apologies. Leanne, over to you. You want to contribute to that question too.
Thank you. From my perspective, the things that contribute to that inconsistency is definitely there is a funding gap. When it's children's services and education that are funding placements and are funding opportunities and experiences for young people, that's challenging enough. But when that moves into health and social care partnerships, and when it moves through, the funding doesn't follow the young person. So there's no smooth pathway, there's no coherent way through. And I think the second thing, and I know I keep saying this, and I will keep saying it, is that there's no strategy. There doesn't appear to be any overarching strategy that we have the data, we know who these young people are, and we know what is likely to be required. So I think there is a definite lack of strategy around that, and I'm really hopeful that the bill can address some of that.
Thank you. Can I get your final...
Yes, you can.
Will there be opportunity to expand on some of these challenges as the session goes on? But can I just sort of flip it and ask the panel just briefly what how they would define a successful transition for an individual, acknowledging that our children and young people will all be very different and success will look different for everyone, but how would they define it and how should we be measuring whether we're getting it right? And I suppose that will be on for the wider cohort as well as for individuals. If I could come to Rebecca first, please.
Yep, sure. I think that it's going to look different for different people. Mm-hmm. But for me, a successful transition, the parent and carer and the young person are going to report satisfaction with the process. the young person has moved into a suitable service that meets their need, and they've sustained that service as well. For me, looking at breaking down what a good transition might look like, it could be a series of transition meetings starting much earlier, making sure that the views, the interests, and most importantly, the aspirations of the young person have been listened to. Things like exploring options, taster events, open days, linked courses, ensuring that social care assessments happen in ample time, that the funding is put in place, travel training is delivered if required, transition visits happen, there's clear engagement and discussions about the expectations of the course, how assessment's going to happen, how teaching will be delivered, assessment of needs has happened in plenty of time, and if relevant, a buddy or a mentor is provided to the young person. And that's obviously all related to post-school learning in terms of success.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to contribute in addition to what Rebecca's said? Oh, Jenny, please. Thank you.
I think I totally agree with all of that, but I guess when I was thinking about this last night, I thought if we can show evidence across all the principles of good transitions, where, you know, families and the young people themselves are saying that they're accessing the life they choose, then I think we can say that we're successful. We've got those principles, and there are, you know, underlying elements that need to be achieved, and I think we should be measuring against those.
Thank you. Can I go to Andy now and then Leanne? Thanks.
I think in terms of measuring the success of the process, I think, yeah, the outcomes are about whether the person feels that they've had choice and control in that planning process. You could also say, are they doing what they want to do? And that would be an outcome. But a really important point, I think, for us is that a successful or an effective or a smooth planning process doesn't guarantee that. It's not within the gift of a successful transitions plan that someone will get the support they need to live independently or to do a photography course at college or to whatever. Do you know that depends on the availability of services and options that any amount of planning can't guarantee. So, you know, and there's nothing in this bill which will improve adult services per se. Mm. It'll improve, hopefully, access to for people to get the services that they want, if those services are available. But without the funding to improve what's available, you know, it would be wrong to say that transitions planning has been a failure because someone couldn't access a photography course at college that doesn't exist.
Thank you. That's a helpful point.
And lastly, on this point, it's Leanne, please. Yes, it's your computer.
Thank you. I would agree with my colleagues entirely, and I would also add that it's really important that the young people that we are talking about here have agency in this and have, for me, that's a key measure of success, is this supporting a young person to thrive and to live a fulfilling and meaningful life. And I think from the starting point of where we are right now, for me, a key measure of success is this upholding the rights of this young person? Because I would have to say that in a lot of cases, transition processes certainly do not do that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your contributions there. Questions from Ruth. Can I now move to Stephen Kerr, please?
Yeah, so one of the things that's impressed me in our engagement with parents and carers and is how fitting the Scottish Transitions Forum's principles of good transitions are. Every turn of our discussion seems to have touched on one of those seven principles. So my question is basically, how successful has the Scottish Transitions Forum been in improving transition processes, particularly in the light of the relevance and effectiveness of these seven principles? Maybe I can just start with Leanne.
with our young people at New Struan, CLAC Manager is not part of the pilot area for this, and we, although we do have young people from across Scotland, 11 local authorities at the moment placed with us, I'm really not seeing those principles come through into practice, unfortunately, although I do think there is a will there. I think the barriers to that are the things we've spoken about already around lack of provision. I don't think there's any argument with the principles of it. It's just that it is very difficult to translate that across into how that actually is improving outcomes for a young person at the moment.
Right.
Although I am hopeful that will improve.
That's a very clear answer. Thank you very much. Now to Andy. Thank you, convener. Keep prompting me. Andy or Jenny?
Sorry, Andy. Over to you.
I haven't been able to find a recent update on how well the pilots are being implemented. I completely agree that the principles themselves are great, and the principles into practice document is really helpful. But I wasn't able to get anything more recent than 2021 on the Transitions Forum website, so I haven't seen a recent report of the pilot areas.
Thank you, Andy. And Jenny?
I think we contributed to the principles of good practice, of good transition. We have a film that highlights what our families feel. And the work of the forum, I think, has brought together research that over decades has highlighted what good transitions are. But I think raising awareness about best practice is excellent and much needed. But I don't feel that it's seeing the change that we need in practice. And I think, as we said, lack of resources of specialist staff skilled in supporting, particularly those in more complex health and social care needs, of partnership working means that we're still not getting it right for some of the most excluded and marginalised. And we know what to do. And the transition guide tells us what to do, but we just need to try and see how we can follow them. But no, unfortunately, we're not seeing that practice is being put in place.
Okay, and Rebecca.
So I guess looking at the Scottish Transitions Forum as a whole, I think that does have an impact on young people and parents and helping to empower them and embolden them in terms of advocating for their rights. The transition and the seven principles themselves are based on legislation, guidance, research. So they're endorsed by organisations across the country. So they do really represent a benchmark for excellence. In terms of the practical framework, unfortunately, the timing isn't ideal right now because they were massively delayed in terms of getting the pilot up and running. I believe that they're going to have some formal evaluation at the end of March, but they are seeing early indicators of success. So, touching on a point that was raised earlier, one local authority have already, as a result of the pilot, decided actually we do need a permanent transitions coordinator, and they're starting to look across transitions and young people on the school roll years in advance. So, you know, really making a difference to how those transitions will be planned in that area. But, you know, I kind of understand the rest of the panel's view. At the moment, we're not seeing that rolled out. I guess it's still early days, and we really do need that strategic buy-in in order to make that happen.
So we've got the principles, but we don't have the implementation. There's a huge gap. So to be more specific about transition plans now, how effective are the health-focused transition plans? For example, the CAMHS transition care plans. Maybe I can start with Jenny on that.
Yeah, I think for our group, they have complex healthcare needs. A lot of our group don't hit the CAMHS services. And I think they're seriously lacking. Families talk about, you know, having to, many families have had to give up employment because they have to attend so many appointments across a week. There's no coordination. Most of the group that we support have no access to allied health professions. You know, you needed 3 days physio and OT input as a child, but suddenly you hit adult services and there is nothing. So I think the coordination, certainly for our group, we would say is really poor. And and definitely need some work. And certainly Chas also asked me if I would definitely mention that, because I think they spend a lot of time supporting that palliative care transition as well, and there was research done to that, and you know, that fails families. One member of staff said to me, you know, we've advanced in medical practice so far, and a lot of our young people are living longer lives, but social care and health transitions into adult services doesn't seem to have caught up.
Right, it's interesting. We actually met a mother on Monday evening who had given up her job in order to be able to do exactly what you've just described. So what you're saying absolutely sits with the evidence we've already received. Maybe I can ask Leanne to comment on that. Health-focused transition plans, how effective?
There are some very smooth transitions that take place. In my experience, that's particularly where we have a learning disabilities nurse on board with our young people. They tend to be able to work miracles that the rest of us mere mortals can only dream of for our young people. However, there is for the young people I support, particularly those who are residential with us, there's often a change between health boards when they move on from us, moving from, for example, Forth Valley to Aberdeen. And so there is a transition within a transition, so services need to transfer that information. I have young people who conversely come in to me at 16, who it takes up to 9 months for the health aspect of that to catch up, which leaves us in a real hiatus to get the right support for our young people, and relies heavily, as we've touched on in other areas, on the relationships between the professionals across the disciplines. It tends to be that shifts things rather than a coherent plan within that. So I think there's a great deal of room for improvement, and particularly where there is a movement geographically between health boards.
Very interesting. Thank you for that. Andy, your experience of health-focused transition plans, how effective are they?
Yeah, well, no. From what we've heard, there's still an issue of coordination between children's health services and adult health services, whether that's mental health or physical health, and the plans haven't helped an awful lot. And an additional issue is that people have told us regularly that one thing we really object to is having multiple plans that either duplicate or complicate. So having to tell their stories over and over again is difficult and upsetting. So to have someone have a health plan and a transitions plan and a child's plan, and then going into adulthood and having an adult support plan, it's not the best way of doing things. So there needs to be better coordination between health-based plans and a more general transitions plan that doesn't require young people to go through their same stories again and again.
Yeah, we keep coming back, don't we, to these principles that the Scottish Transition Forum have set out about the importance of coordination of services.
Principles.
Sorry?
Yeah, the great principles. Yeah,
absolutely. But it's this gap between the principles that everyone agrees and actually the experience of people. Yeah. Families and the individuals concerned. And finally, I think Rebecca, if you'd comment on the effectiveness of these health focused transition plans.
Well, working purely from an educational perspective, I probably wouldn't be the best place to comment on that. But what I would say, what is reflected from parents calling the helpline, is that often young people are not having access to health services. So they're actually starting post-school learning without having a proper support in place due to capacity and waiting lists. And that then has a knock-on effect in terms of how well they're able to engage in their learning. And colleges will often comment that actually it's not their place to be able to pick that up or to deliver that wellbeing support.
Right. So staying with you, Rebecca, I think there's been a lot of comment on this, but I just want to give you the opportunity to put this on the record for our evidence. But how do you feel young people and their families' views are taken into account during the transition process?
I think that's a incredibly inconsistent, again, with everything. Parents tell us that often they're not listened to, they're not trusted, you know, they're not considered to be experts in terms of how best to meet their young person's needs. We're often told that young people are being forced to leave school before they're ready, or they're being forced into placements that are not suitable to meet their needs, because, as we've discussed earlier, there is no other placement. So it's really not looking at the young person in a holistic way, taking their views, and again, really thinking about their aspirations and what they want to achieve in life, is not always placed at the centre of that planning process.
Yeah, we're going to come back to that point. Thank you. Thank you for that. Jenny, the question is about young people and families' views. I think we've got the gist of what everyone's going to say, but I think it's important for you to put it on the record.
Yeah, I totally agree with Rebecca. I mean, we have, as I say, a project in Glasgow where we have a link worker who supports families and the young person themselves through a PAMIS digital passport. And that looks at aspirations and where people want to go, and the worker spends time and, you know, visiting places. But in reality, families are so desperate that the GERFIC principles all go out the window and people just grab whatever they can, because there is a risk or a feeling that there'll be nothing. So I think, you know, those aspirations, which, you know, we all strive to achieve, just tend to go out of the window, and people feel that they have to accept what's on offer. And and it does go back also into the skill of the person doing the assessment in the adult services to really understand that individual, and not only to take into account what the family and the young person are saying, but also what that team that know the family around them, as they believe there's a lot of tacit knowledge, I feel, that goes missing, you know, during that process. So, it's grim. But when it is done properly, and when people, you know, are able to really look at what they are aspiring to do, it could be amazing.
Thank you. Andy, would you like to add anything?
Yeah. So I think it's really important to recognise that no professionals and staff who are involved in the planning process wants anything but the best for these young people. But I think the issue is that planning, this kind of future planning, is a really complicated thing to do. I mean, I don't know about anyone else, but I hadn't a clue what I wanted to do with my life when I was 16, let alone 14, which is when the planning should start. I hadn't a clue. I didn't even know what I wanted to do when I left school, you know, 6 months, a year away. It's complicated by the fact that people don't all leave school at the same time. Some do leave at 16, but some stay until 18. So when do these conversations start? How are they carried on? What do you make of what someone said at 14 when they're 17? You know, and so I think working with a young person and their family who might want something entirely different from what the young person wants themselves, to work with those two agents, I suppose, the young person and their family, and to help them to think through all these issues. Never mind the practicalities of the fact there's no social worker or there's limited college places or whatever. It's a really skilled job. So I think we need to recognise that process and say that is one of the key success factors to successful transition, is the quality of the staff who are supporting the planning process. Whether it's a guidance teacher, which is what the bill recommends, or anyone else. It's a skill that shouldn't be recognised and does require specialist training, I would say.
I want to come back to that for my final question, but I think I should allow Leanne to add anything to what's been said already. Leanne.
Again, I would agree with my colleagues. I think I hear in meetings time after time of parents and carers tell us that they feel at the mercy of a system, they feel disenfranchised, and exactly as we've been discussing, and particularly Andy's point, that it's the relationships in order for parents to feel that they have that agency, that they can make these plans effectively. It really does rely on trust and knowing that the professionals that you're sitting around a table with understand where you're coming from, and fortunately the system as it is at the moment means that they face losing that support on top of all of these other difficulties of relationships and people they know so well. So I think the word I would use at the moment is disenfranchised. I think a lot of my families are telling me that that's how they feel around transitions.
So staying with you, Leanne, my final question for all of you is around the effectiveness of the careers information, advice and guidance in terms of identifying opportunities for disabled children and young people. And then a little bit more on how practitioners can best achieve the balance between meeting the practical needs of the people concerned and helping young people achieve their aspirations for the future. So maybe, Leanne, you began to talk about this. You've all touched on it. Would you like to say something more about the effectiveness of the careers information, advice and guidance and how best practitioners achieve this balance?
But the population that I support, for the young people I work with, we are fortunate that we have a very good relationship with Skills Development Scotland, and we have a very good link within that system who actively seeks opportunities. Again, where that becomes convoluted for our young people is the geographical element, that I work with young people who are the vast majority placed out of authority. I would echo, as colleagues have said earlier on, that the problem then becomes the barriers are what these young people need in the way of support to access the opportunities. And that shouldn't be a barrier. If the opportunity exists, that should be a given. That should be the starting point. And we shouldn't be trying to retrofit a system around young people once something has been identified. The cohort of young people I support, there are definitely different challenges within that. So for some of our young people, it's accessing the right support to enable them to get to the opportunity. For other young people, there is a real lack of appropriate opportunity that will allow these further development of skills. As we've talked about earlier, only one specialist college within Scotland. And I think there is a real deficit there that we need to address.
Thank you for that. Andy, you began to address the subject of this last question in your previous answer. Do you want to build on that, please?
I don't think the careers advice service has served people with learning disabilities well over the years, and that's been probably really of low expectations and low imagination. There was a recent review of the careers advice service with a number of recommendations, and so one of which is taking the principles of good transitions into account. So that might improve. But I think you just need to look at the picture for people with learning disabilities to see how limited it is. So 50% of school leavers with learning disabilities go to college. It seems like it's the default position, and that's the careers advice for some young people. I'll just go to college, and then they can decide. 4% of young people adults with learning disabilities are in work. 4%. That's a tenth of the number of disabled people that are in work, which is poor enough. Mm-hmm. So it's appalling. So careers advice officers do not direct people into work or give them the advice that they need to get into work. So I think must do better.
Must do better.
Is what we'd say.
And a comment on the practitioner's balance, the need for the balance between practical and aspiration. The practical needs of the children and young people concerned, and their aspirations. How do the practitioners best achieve a balance?
Do you mean between the young people's aspirations and what's possible?
Yes.
Well, I think the first thing is to see what is possible. Do you know? But also to recognise that aspirations will take you in a direction. I've got an anecdotal story about a young person who said that they wanted to be an astronaut, right? So they had a support worker who said, okay, well, obviously not being an astronaut. But what's the nearest thing to being an astronaut? Planes? Okay, took them to an airport, and every week they went to the airport. And the guy spent as much time looking at the pack, the suitcase carousels, as he did at the aeroplanes. Got into conversation with someone that worked at the carousels, who said, come back and see what happens behind the scenes. Did that a few months later. And so we did this regularly every week. A few months later, a job came up at the airport, working at the carousels. He went for a job and had the best practical experience and knowledge of what went on, and he got the job.
That's a great story.
Nothing to do with being an astronaut.
Yeah.
But you see what happens. If you don't dismiss the aspiration, it can take you places.
That's a great story. Andy, thank you for sharing that.
Is that you done?
Just Jenny and Rebecca haven't had a chance to answer the question. Maybe okay. If they have anything they wish to add. Convener is indicating that she wants to move on. But maybe Jenny, do you have anything you wish to add?
Yeah, I would really love to, if that's okay.
Yeah,
One of our families says, use your imagination and use all your senses, because when we work collectively, we can make things like that happen. And young people do have aspirations, and they also have a human right, I think, to lifelong learning. And we feel that when we come together collectively and we really listen to families who know how to use their imagination and the young people, we actually can come up with some really fantastic solutions. We have been talking with families, and we would love to talk further about lifelong learning and opportunities. There isn't one college course that our group couldn't not only participate in, but also educate others. So I think that bit that Andy says is just a lovely approach. And this mum always says, please use your imagination and all your senses, because then you make the impossible possible.
Fantastic. And Rebecca, anything else you wish to add?
I would just echo what's been said already, that delivery of career information, advice and guidance can be quite patchy, but in terms of having expertise and the skill to particularly support young disabled people, we've not seen particularly good practice around that. So again, are they best placed to do that? Is more training required? Really just to echo about that person-centred approach in terms of planning. And I think we've all got lots of anecdotes, similar to Andy, around having a starting point and, again, having the time, the capacity, the skill and the expertise to be able to explore that and see where that might take the young person. A social worker once said to me, just because they want to do that, I want to do a master's, but I can't get the funding for that. But it's about, the equity for this young person and exploring what they can achieve and obtain within what's available.
First class. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen Kerr. There was a lot of ground covered there, and you might find there's a bit of overlap with topics that are coming further down through the session. So apologies for that. But can we move to questions now from Graham Day, please?
Thank you, Convener. I want to take this in a slightly different direction, if I may. I think we've touched upon this morning, helpfully, the issues around the gap between the implementation of current policy duties and intent and the experience of young people and their families. If you have other examples, that's fine. We're delighted to hear them. But I wonder if we look at this from a slightly different perspective. Just imagine we didn't have this bill in front of us, and we were having a session today where we were asking you the very questions that I've covered there. But we then said, so what could be done to address this? What could you do if not this bill? So, for example, if we were to have things like ring fencing of allocations of funds to support young people through transition, if we were to the point that was raised earlier about the transition planning process, that it doesn't become mandatory until 6 months before, if that were addressed in some way, if we change the language that tends to be used around legislation from mays and shalls to must, would that help? Those are just three ideas I put in there for you to think about. I hope you have many others. So as I say, let's imagine we don't have this bill. We were just trying to address some of these horrendous issues we're hearing about. What would you do? Who wants to go first? Andy?
That's a great question. Can I give you a couple of things straight away and then maybe come back? So one thing I would do is I would say there has to be dedicated transitions workers. Make that mandatory. And sorry, I had something else and it's gone. Can I come back?
Of course, so I sprung this on you, so absolutely.
So, I'm looking if someone else wants to come in. How about, can we go to Jenny? Perhaps you can answer that one.
Yeah, I'm not sure I can, but I do agree about, I think training so that people understand what is expected. But I guess the bit that always seems to be missing is the accountability and what happens if you know, people don't have transition plans. What happens if you know, there isn't a dedicated worker? What happens if it's the accountability and the teeth, really, that I often feel is missing? Because, you know, families come to us and say, I don't know where to go, I haven't got anything, and we go to the local authorities. But so this sounds maybe unprofessional, but there's almost a so what, you know, so what if they haven't? And, you know, I think that then leaves families feeling isolated and dejected, and young people feeling that they just don't matter. So, yeah, how do we make everybody feel valued so that there's something about where that accountability is? But no, I'm sorry, I don't. And I think training is absolutely essential. But there has to be something behind it that makes it happen, doesn't there?
Yeah.
Leanne McCauley is keen to come on this response.
Good.
Completely agree with everything Jenny said. Accountability is the key here. And the accountability cannot sit with the person who holds the purse strings either. The accountability needs to be independent of that. And I think picking up on what Jenny said about being aspirational for our young people, we need to turn this on its head. Our young people with disabilities should not be an afterthought. Their adulthood, they are adults for an awful lot longer than they are children. So we need to be planning to get this right. And there needs to be a minimum expectation around that supports the aspirations of young people. And without legislation, I'm not sure how that accountability can be brought about, and that's for other people than me to decide. But those would be the two things, and I think at the centre of it, there has to be a really hold on to the principles that young people are not deprived of their rights and liberties because the system doesn't fit them. And that is something that I hear time and time again.
Andy is now keen to come back in. So, Andy.
Yes, I've remembered the thing I was going to say, which was continuity in relationships are really important here, and they've been mentioned by others. And I would say the one way to support that is to create an all-age service. And obviously that's being considered by the National Care Service at the moment. I know there's critics and reasons why not, but I think that would allow continuity for a named professional to have a relationship with each young person going through for a continued period of time, and this is supported by lots of different things that are all going on and all aligns with us. For example, we've been involved in the Margaret Fleming review, the young woman with learning disabilities that was murdered murdered by her carers. And one thing that came out really strongly was that she became invisible after she left school, and there was no one agency that had any responsibility for her. And so it's that. When we think about accountability, it's an accountability for someone's life, not just their passage from childhood to adulthood.
Okay.
I believe Rebecca also wants to comment on that. Thank you.
So first of all, just to echo, we need transition services across every board. We need one person to be dedicated for families to be able to turn to try and get transitions right. I think we also need an urgent review of the availability of appropriate provision, what services are available for young people when they're leaving school. Really, it's a national disgrace, the lack of appropriate provision there is for young disabled people moving on. I'm not convinced about legislation going to achieve the improved outcomes for disabled young people. That's purely based on experience of other legislation that's in place, for example, the Equality Act, where the accountability, having teeth, the repercussions, the difficulty for young people and disabled people to be able to engage in that process and advocate and overcome barriers that they face.
Thanks, Kavira, and thank you, Rebecca. That leads me on to my second question, which is everyone here today and everyone who's been involved in the discussions is looking for improved outcomes. That's what we're about. It's not about processes and legislation, it's about improved outcomes. But one of the criticisms that's been levelled at this proposed bill, rightly or wrongly, is that part of it replicates already existing duties. Do you accept that criticism, and does that cause you some concern that we just create more legislation when in actual fact what we really need is to sharpen up the legislation we have, or use this bill to do that, so we get where we want to here and actually improve the opportunities for these young people? Do you want to pick up on that, Rebecca, first?
I'm particularly critical of that, not necessarily replicating, but adding to the legislation, adding to the existing duties. We hear all the time from parents that things are really complex, it's complicated, it's difficult to navigate the system. You're adding layer upon layer, you're looking at another piece of legislation, and there's no detail about how this bill will interact and align with the current legislation that's already there. We need to simplify, we need to clarify it for people, and we need to focus on practice and capacity and resourcing.
Anybody else want to pick up on that? Leanne?
Yes, there is an overlap between the legislation. I am less uncomfortable around that, the perspective of, well, as an educator, highly regulated sector, legislation is what I often have to rely on to get the best outcomes for my young people. I have to be able to use that legislation and to rely on it and refer to it to get what we need. I think there are gaps that particularly some of the young people that I support fall between, and they're not quite covered by one set of legislation, and they don't quite fit the bill for the other set of legislation, whereas I believe that this bill does have the potential to be a net for those gaps. And I think that the more ways that we can work together for the best outcomes, that for me is what this should be about.
Okay.
And does anyone else want to come in on that?
No.
Okay. Oh, Andy. Sorry. It's a bit... Thank you, Andy. I'm not seeing all four. So if you can put an R in the chat, if that's helpful. Okay. I only see who's ever speaking.
Sure.
Thank you. Andy,
sure.
Over to you.
Thank you. Yeah, no, I just wanted to reiterate the point earlier about the duplication of planning requirements and how difficult it can be for young people with learning disabilities or adults with learning disabilities to be involved in developing a plan. So there's other legislation that requires plans to be provided, and you can end up, one person can end up with lots of different plans which do duplicate and overlap, and each one requires a process to complete. I'd say that's a real downside to this legislation. SLD cautiously supports the legislation, and I think the reason we do support it is because it does bring in a level of accountability, and that is something that is lacking at the moment. Now I think it's maybe a bit clunky in that respect that you were asking about, that there is some duplication, and what's required is simplification of those layers that Rebecca mentioned. But the accountability is really important. That's what this would add.
And Jenny wants to respond as well, finally, from Jenny.
I'm sorry, it's a very quick word. It's just, I think it's really sad that we're in this position where we have to bring that in. But, you know, there are 30 or 40 years worth of research and evidence that tells us how to do it, and we still can't do it. And I remember being a practitioner thinking that I'd nailed it before I moved on to another job 25 years ago. You know, so I think it's... sad, but it is that accountability. And I think there's an absolute desperation from the community that they feel they have to get behind something because it's just not happening.
Thank you. A very short sort of follow-on question from myself. I mean, we've heard about things being a bit clunky, the downsides to and the gaps, and this legislation will be that net for the gaps. I think that was Leanne that said those lines specifically. But what aspects of the bill, as it's been laid out right now, that you've seen, would the panel change? Can we perhaps go to Leanne first, if that's possible?
Yep.
Sorry, put you on the spot.
I think what would I change? Definitely something in here around where that accountability lies is not clear enough for me yet within this bill. I would like more detail around the national strategy for this. Those are the two big things. I will probably have more to say when I've had time to think. So if a colleague could help me out, that would be much appreciated.
Yes, is there anyone else indicating the one? No, would anyone else like to come in on their thoughts about what might change? Leanne, you can always write to us if you don't get the chance to say things in the session with other... Jenny, please. It's indicating.
Yeah, I guess there was ensuring that there is that real emphasis on those health transitions as well as the social care transitions, I think, is really important. And that accountability, what happens if actions aren't followed? And just, I mean, I know it is, but ensuring that it has a human rights-based approach and that it is co-produced, that the strategy is co-produced. As we said, children and young people and the families often have the best solutions and the most creative ideas. And when we bring that collective wisdom, I think we can make more of a difference.
Thank you for that. I'm going to go straight back to Graham Day to cover some questions around the actual national strategy. Okay.
Thanks. Me again. Apologies. I just wonder, from your perspective, whether a national transition strategy, providing it was based on best practice and what you know works well, would support more consistent approaches across the country and therefore better outcomes. And if it would, how do you think that could be made to work in practice?
Who would go to first? Andy, I'm sorry. Were you able to answer that?
So our reservations about the bill were not so much about anything that was proposed in it. We wouldn't suggest different changes, but just a more general scepticism about the effectiveness of legislation to change things and the effectiveness of a strategy as a means to change things. And that's really based on a number of learned disability strategies that we've been aware of and other strategies that have probably, for all intents and purposes, sat on the shelf after being written until they're reviewed for the next strategy to be written. So we're slightly jaundiced about that. It's the implementation problem. And creating a strategy sucks energy out of, you know, doing your day job, doing your work. And so the risk is that when you've got a national strategy or a lot of energy into creating the strategy, nothing happens for 3 years or a year until the reporting period kicks in.
Okay.
So what do you do about that? I'm not sure. I think if you spoke to, or when you speak to folks from HSCPs, I'm sure they will say, just making something statutory doesn't mean we're going to do it, because we've got so many statutory obligations and so few staff. We're in crisis. And so the thing that would make a difference to all this, the thing that would make the national strategy work and the statutory duty to do transitions planning with individuals is funding. And when we consulted individuals on this, the original consultation back in 2019, someone said, the elephant in the room is resources. Without them, forget it. To believe we could deliver the bill within existing resources is naive and fantastical. And someone else said that the bill proposal is a great plan that can be executed. So it's that's what's going to take it. The bill itself is fine. What it's proposing is fine. Accountability to ministers is fine, but it's not going to be enacted effectively without resources.
Jenny, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree with Andy. I just made a note. It's absolutely about how you put the resource behind, because if there's nowhere to transit to as well, if there are no services, you could have the best transition plan, but then not have the resources to access. But I also wonder whether sometimes what's needed is, you know, the Fraser of Allen are doing cost-benefit analysis of how money is saved when you get it right. And making sure that people then believe from an economic perspective about why they're doing it. And I mean, developing, you know, communities of practice where best practice, which I think is absolutely what the Transition Forum is doing, sharing that best practice, but absolutely elevating that and supporting other health and social care partnerships to take on what their colleagues have done in other areas. I think a strategy would be great if it has the resource at the output.
Okay.
Thank you very much for those responses. Can we move to questions now from my deputy convener, Co-Cab Stewart, please?
Thank you, convener. Thank you very much, panel. I've listened with great interest. Your perspectives have been very informative. I wanted to ask some questions around who the bill should cover and how the young people should be identified. So that's my two bits. The first bit about who it should cover. So regarding age and the definition of disability as well, as stated in the Equalities Act. But do you think that is proper? Will that cover everybody? Will the young people be able to be identified, considering not all of them will be in a system already? You know, it's a variety of needs that people have, so they might not already be in a system, if you know what I mean. So there are challenges around that. So I'd be interested to hear how local authorities can identify children and young people that would be eligible without anybody falling through the net. Could I start with Jenny, please?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was hoping you wouldn't start with me, but the group that we support are children with very complex needs, and they are pretty identifiable. And I think, as Leanne says, it is pretty awful that actually when they hit adult services, people are shocked and surprised, because they have been there, you know, since birth. You know that there are going to be needs as they go forward. But I think the way we collect data and share data, you know, if they're not, well, they will be known to education, but they're certainly known to health. So we need to definitely make sure that all parties are connecting and working together. And I guess, I mean, my other thought, because I was thinking about this again last night, was that actually teachers and education recognise the kids that are in their systems that will need support. But how does that get, you know, how do we come together in multi-agencies to describe that? And I do think the third sector has a role to play in that, in identifying individuals that maybe come to them but aren't known to other areas. So for me, it's a multifaceted, multi-agency approach where data is shared and concerns are shared that enables people to move forward. But I know that at the moment is problematic. I don't think I've answered your question now, have I? Sorry.
You've had a good stab at it. Let's see if one of your colleagues, let's go to Andy.
So SCLD's constituency is everyone with a learning disability, and so yes, we would say that everyone with a learning disability should be up for having a transitions plan. One issue is about diagnosis, and we definitely don't think it should be open only to people that have a formal diagnosis of a learning disability, because we know that it can be difficult, and in some areas more than others, there's a reluctance from educational psychologists, for example, to diagnose and to assess and diagnose young people as having learning disabilities because of the stigma. So we think it should be done by self-identification, but also, as just been suggested, so identification by other people, other professionals, teachers, for example, say, so-and-so should qualify for getting a transitions plan. And then we think that there should be a, it should be done on an opt-out basis. I think that, that people should, young people who are entitled to a transitions plan should be offered one. It should, and it should not be up to them to opt in and to ask for one or to be said, you're entitled, do you want one? The expectation is that everyone that's entitled is given a transitions plan. But thinking back to 14-year-olds and 15-year-olds, there could be a bit of stigma attached to even going through that that planning process when some of their peers aren't. And so the encouragement should be there, and the benefits of going through that planning process should be made clear to the young people. But even given that, some folk at 14 or 15 will opt out of the transition process, and that should be okay as well.
Thank you for that. I wonder if Leanne or Rebecca would like to come in.
Will we go to Leanne? Leanne, will we come to you? Is that okay?
Yeah, that's great. I would argue that we do know who these young people are. As a teacher, we provide a great deal of data to the system, for want of a better way of putting it. So we gather that data through the annual pupil census. We gather that data through CMIS and the tracking systems in education, got the looked after children's system. You've also got the care inspectorate. There is, I think we have a wealth of data and ways of knowing who these young people are. I absolutely agree that, that self-identification and the ability to opt out, but that the principle should be that that you are offered this. But I would certainly say that if our systems worked more cohesively together, that there would be a very clear picture would emerge actually about young people and their needs, which would then inform the strategy. So I think we do have the data.
Okay, thank you. Was it Rebecca? Just in case Rebecca wanted to say something. But while people were thinking, I'm just thinking about, you were talking about, you know, most young people will be easily identifiable, but obviously there are the bill's scope and with regards to mental health conditions. Do you think it sufficiently recognises those with mild to moderate mental health conditions or people going through mental health crisis, and we've alluded to it, those that have fluctuating supports as well. So I'm just mindful that not everything is visible in that sense. So regarding the definition based on the Equality Act of disability, the definition, who should determine eligibility in the first instance? And if there are disputes, which inevitably there are, then how would they be resolved? So, Rebecca, I've got you in front of me, so feel free to comment on my previous bit, but I'm quite happy for you to move on to my next question area. Thanks.
Yeah, just on the previous bit, I mean, we support young people who are pan impairment, so it's not one specific issue that we might be advising over. And I think that the proposal could be quite problematic if there's going to be a statutory duty to provide a plan for every child and young person who's considered disabled under the Act for a variety of different reasons. We hear all the time from disabled young people that they don't identify with the language of disability, they don't identify as being disabled. Mm. There's also the issue around the fact that the current language that governs legislation around transition is additional support needs. And it includes a much wider scope for perhaps people with mild to moderate health, mental health issues who might actually meet the definition of disability under the Equality Act. But you know, that could be a challenge that needs to happen in order to try to clarify that. So referring to additional support needs, I think, as a wider umbrella would be more helpful. I think it can be quite difficult to track young people after they leave school. Yes, that the data is there when they're at school, but we have to remember that a lot of young people are not engaging in services. They don't have access to healthcare. They're on waiting lists, so they don't have access to social services. So I think it would be very difficult to track young people when they leave.
Thanks, Rebecca. I wonder if anyone would like to come in. Just raise your hand, because I've got four in the screen, if anyone wants to. Nobody wants to come back in on that one. Just as a final then, if everybody sort of like looking at the scope of it, in the financial memorandum, it suggests that around 4,000 school leavers a year would meet the definition currently of disabled, and that being around 8% of school leavers from state schools. Do you think that that is a reasonable estimate? And I'll go to Leanne. Thank you.
That's a really difficult question for me to answer. I think it's a place to start, certainly. I think that some of the... that if we're making the assumption that those who are placed in schools like mine, specialist services, or within enhanced provision within local authorities are also included within that, that number feels a little low to me. But I think, again, that will come down to the definition and how we look at that, which doesn't really answer your question, I know, but I'm not sure how to give you more from my perspective on that.
Okay. Is there anybody else that would like to come in on that? I suppose what I'm after is whether that is a reasonable number. Do we think that it's going to be a lot more? That kind of estimate, whether you agree with it. So I wonder if, should we go? Andy, do you have anything to add to that? Feel free to shake your head. It's okay.
I'm not sure if it's a reasonable number, but I do think the financial memorandum is an underestimate of what's needed. It's not so much because of the number 4,000, but some of the other assumptions that are made in the financial memorandum, I think, err on the low side significantly. And one assumption is just shocking, really. One of the big assumptions that's wrong, I think, is that it'll only take 4 hours per meeting. And 1 hour only is allowed for coordinating the meeting and bringing people together and preparing people for the meeting. And I just think, you know, have you ever planned a meeting, a multi-agency meeting? I think that's a vast underestimate. So at the very least, it would take another hour. You know, so that's a 20% increase straight away on the estimated cost. There's an assumption, there's an attrition assumption, which means that after people have left school, some folk will be less likely to engage, and they should just be allowed to drop off. And that's the shocking thing. I think it should not be allowed to happen. It's just in the financial memorandum, it's just stated as if that's just a fact. People don't answer phone calls and say you just let them go. And I just think that's, you know, it comes back to my point about having a contact person. If someone's not answering phone calls or your emails, then you keep trying, you find out where they live or whatever, you do whatever it takes to make contact. And then if people are making an informed choice that they don't want to be involved in the planning process anymore, yes, but you do whatever it takes to stay in touch and find out what's changed about their circumstances.
Okay, thanks, Andy. Can I bring Jenny in, please?
Yeah, and I would totally agree with Andy. I remember I was feeling a bit alarmed about the length of time, particularly for our group, that it would require. But one of the other things that I think might be really useful to look at is the impact of COVID on young people's mental health. And I wonder whether those numbers will fluctuate. That isn't an area of expertise, but I just note that there seems to be in a lot of the CAMHS teams a higher increase of referrals, and young people seem to have really, really struggled with, you know, the 2 years of lockdown, which has had an adverse effect on their mental health. So you know, will we see more numbers of young people with mental health issues requiring sort of further support? I wonder whether those numbers are low. And again, just reiterating the fact that our young people now are expected to live a lot longer than they were. So those numbers are ever increasing because of the amazing stuff that happens medically.
Thank you. Thanks, panel. Convener.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Co-Cab Stewart. Can I move to questions from Willie Rennie, please?
One of the advantages of doing legislation like this is, irrespective of the content of the proposed bill, it shines a focus. It gives a focus onto the issues. And within the last period, I've been fortunate. I met the usual place in Dumfries, who attended an event I was at last week, and they provide confident leadership in disability. I've also familiar with Zest Cafe in St Andrews. And Lisa, who runs that organisation, has no time at all for employers who say they can't get enough people to work for their organisations. She employs people with learning difficulties and from a variety of different backgrounds and disabilities. She thinks employers are not educating themselves enough to understand the talent that's available amongst this cohort. Now, not everybody, but quite a lot of them. What more do you think we can do to educate employers into the assets that they're missing out on? Perhaps start with Jenny.
We have a real thing about the folk that we work with, that profound means deep, wise and expert. And actually, if you turn some of these words that have negative connotations into positive ones, I learn on a daily basis from somebody who can't communicate with me verbally, but certainly teaches me when I'm doing something wrong or not interacting in the right way. So I think that we have been trying for many, many years, and I used to be an occupational therapist working in the supported employment field, and it is sad that we still haven't got employers that recognise the benefits. But I know that we've also had conversations about the fact that people with a learning disability often provide a set of skills that the rest of us don't. I certainly know that those people with a learning disability that work with our group have patience that none of the rest of us have. And I wonder whether we should be opening up wider opportunities for them to really shine a light on the skills that they have. But I think a lot of that goes back to how we work with children and young people at schools to make sure that we value everybody throughout our career. Because if you get it right at a very early age and you give children the tools to include everybody, then they will. It's the moment that we start segregating and not providing the right play equipment or the right resources that kids get excluded, and then they're seen as not valuable contributors to their society. So I would recommend that we start very early in school, making sure that people value each other, and then we grow the next generation, because I'm struggling to know what we do with this generation. But profound does mean deep, wise, expert, and it is a beautiful word. And if we use our imagination, we can make things happen.
Rebecca, perhaps you can come in on this.
Yep, sure. I think that focus on employers getting it right is the right tactic, because previously it's been about trying to upskill disabled people and think about what they can do differently to try and get into work. So I'm part of the Scottish Government's PSP on supporting, as part of the Disabled Action Plan, supporting employers. So there's currently work happening at the moment, which is being led by SUSE, around developing what's known as a centre of excellence for employers. So it's about recognising that they need support, they need resource, they need training, and making sure that is available to them. So I think just continued investment in that process.
Okay. Anyone else want? I don't think so. I'm not getting any R's in the chat bar.
That's right.
Okay. Can we move? Oh, sorry, Leanne wants to come in. Sorry. Leanne.
Sorry, it was just to say that I wholeheartedly agree that the focus needs to be on how we shift the thinking. And I really do believe, with the generation of young people in our schools at the moment, that thinking has shifted. And I learn something new every day from the young people that I work with, and their attitudes to life and to society and to the world in general. And I also know within Scottish Autism that there is programmes that we support big employers such as Barclays Bank and others to make the changes that are required to support autistic people in the workforce. So I think that definitely pushing that will open up more opportunities. But I do have real faith in the young people of the generation coming through school today, because I genuinely believe that change is happening now, and that this will improve in the future.
Thank you very much. We have some questions now from Stephanie Callaghan. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and certainly really good to hear that kind of talk about employers. I've got a local employer as well who do pretty much wrap around care with the people that they have, and they get loyalty, a huge amount of commitment as well from those young people too. And it'd be great to have some more information, Rebecca, if you could send that through to committee on the employment stuff that you were talking about as well. That would be fantastic. So you've all mentioned about gaps in services and opportunities for disabled young people when they leave school being really quite limited. Are there key gaps in provision that we should really be focusing on? And if I could start with Rebecca.
Yeah, I'm probably touched on this already. It's about, for me, it's about the options for post-school learning that particularly tailor to the needs of young people, where their needs are not going to be met in a college environment. So it's about an appropriate option, an opportunity. So I would like to see more colleges like Coursework College popping up across the country. I know that's kind of in its pilot stage, so looking at how well that might work and where are the pitfalls there. But when you just have to look to England and what's available there in comparison and why parents feel so angry. But I think, again, that's something that services need to be co-produced with young people and with parents. College isn't going to be the right service. We deliver community-based adult learning at Leeds Scotland to disabled people in their communities, in their own homes. So it's looking at what commissioning of services are going to be required to continue to develop young people's skills and not to kind of fob them off into just a social care setting, but might not be continuing to develop their education to help them become independent adults.
Thank you. And is there anyone else who wants to come in on that?
And Jenny. So
thank you.
Yeah. We'll go to Andy first and then Jenny.
Yeah, I'd agree that the colleges need to be looked at. I think within colleges, there's a dearth of employment-focused courses for people with learning disabilities, but also college has been a really poor experience for people with learning disabilities over the years. Typically, there are exceptions, of course, students would go through independent living skills courses time and time. They would repeat the same course and never get anywhere, and progression was really poor. So there's something that needs to happen there. Independent living is really important to people, and people with learning disabilities might want to leave home, stay at home with their parents longer than other folk in the population. And so it's at college where that's an appropriate time to be thinking about learning skills that you'll need to live independently. So there's one thing is don't get rid of those independent living skills courses for the sake of employment-focused courses only. But you have to make those independent living skills courses relevant and effective and actually building people's skills up, and then there needs to be progression out, and that tends still not to happen after years and years. And as I said, that is the default destination for a lot of people with disabilities when they leave school. And the second thing is that terrible dearth of social work places, which means that assessing folks for support doesn't happen or doesn't happen fast enough, and you have that bottleneck as people are leaving school and they can't move into adult services, they can't get the support they need to move into their own home or to learn to travel independently or to whatever. So that's a real shortage of the workforce as well.
We have Jenny and Leanne wanted to come in on this. I'm just conscious of time.
Yeah, so. Carry on, Jenny. I mentioned PAMIS have also a model of thinking that every young person could go to a whole multitude of courses, which actually then feeds back into the previous discussion about how do you get employers ready. Well, if you've been at college with somebody who has a disability and you've seen the benefits, they teach you as much as you will teach them. So, but there is a real lack of purposeful and meaningful occupation and activity specifically for this group. But it does have to be building based because we need resources that are accessible and inclusive. So, that's a key gap. And education of people, and not expecting somebody who one day was working in a shop to be able to suddenly know how to support an individual with very complex needs. I think it feeds back into what we have in the social care workforce, and that we value, support and enable them to provide opportunities, I think would be my ask.
Leanne, finally from yourself.
I would echo everything my colleagues have said, but I would also say that the cost of not getting this right for young people and the lack of services mean that young people are ending up in hospitals, their liberties removed, and that is it's morally indefensible that this should be allowed to be happening in 2023 in Scotland.
I'll have a short supplementary, but it has just to be the question. Stephanie.
Yeah, so it was really just to pick up on something that Andy and both Jenny said there as well about relationships being incredibly important and being at the centre of it. So based on that, are we getting the things that are in the plan right? Should it be an individual training plan where really up front and centre of that is the young person, what the things that matter to them and the direction that they're looking to go in, their own aspirations?
Jenny, do you want to come in first on that? As you were on the screen. Oh no, Leanne was on the screen. I'm sorry, I've put Jenny first again. Jenny.
Absolutely. The person should be at the centre. They're, you know, if you get it right for them, you will end up getting it right for the whole family. And you know, you will save what Leanne was just talking about people ending up in hospital. But that planning needs to start early. But it also needs to be flexible. You know, the individual, as Andy says, will change what they want to do. They don't want to go to, a college course for the rest of their lives. They might want to get involved in dance and drama and music. So I think it has to be a flexible approach that's revisited, and that people aren't just expected to do the same thing for the rest of their lives, which sadly is what tends to happen at the moment for some people.
Does anyone else want to come in on that? I'm checking my... Nope, there's not. So, no, we've covered a lot of ground in that session, so thank you very much. And as ever, we have to compress it all at the end. It does feel a little bit tight for time, but thank you for that. And we're now going to have a suspension of around 8 minutes to allow for the change of witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back, and sorry for that slight delay. We are now going to take evidence from our second panel today on the Disability Children and Young People Transitions to Adulthood Scotland Bill. And can I welcome Dr. Kandarp Jossi, apologies, the consultant from NHS Grampian, Vice Chair of Child and Adolescent Faculty, the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland. I did struggle with that. Sorry about that. Nicola Kane, Policy and Public Affairs Lead, Scotland, Royal College of Occupational Therapists. Dr. Mary Stark, Scottish Officer, Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health. Now, members will direct a question to one of the panel initially, and if you would like to come in, please feel free to put an R in the chat bar, if you wish to contribute specifically to an answer. Thank you very much. We will move straight to members' questions, and the first group of questions is from my colleague Ruth Maguire, please.
Thank you, convener, and welcome, panel. I'm not sure if you saw the first session. I intend to open up with the questions to you that I asked the first panel around transitions to adult services. I'm going to start off by asking what you, from your perspective, what the key barriers are to supporting those better outcomes that we all want for children and young people as they move into to adult services. If I could go to Dr. Jossi first, please.
Thank you. Thank you for giving this opportunity. I'm getting a bit of an echo, but that might be just me. I did join the last tail end of the panel, the last panel, and I think I'll start by saying that the key bits are resources. And the second bit is culture. And I think for a long time, you know, just like we have in medicine separated mind and body, we have separated children and adults. We have separated children and adult services in a way that now transition is a problem between children and adult services. I think we are working a lot in medicine to rejoin the mind and the body. And no wonder, as a society, we need to work hard to align children and adults again in terms of minimizing the disruption that society has created, and we are trying to repatch it. So I think the key bits is resources. The third point for me to say is about the variability. I think there's a huge variability in Scotland, and we need to accept that. And some of it is about resources, some of it is about the size of the services, some of it is about size of boards, some of it is about how generalist, how specialist a region is. And then that creates such a vast variation in what is available. And I work for a board that has got three local authorities, and within those three local authorities, it's amazing to see what is available and what's not available for making a difference for children. I think there are legislations, and like I think something was said earlier, what this is helping us is focus on something really, really meaningful to make a difference. So I think it's helpful that we have got focus. But for me, those are three highlights: the variation, resources, and culture.
Thank you, that's helpful. Can I just ask you further to that? In your evidence, you state that your members report that when children have multidisciplinary teams that are working well, that provides the best outcome for them. You spoke there about variations across the country and about culture and working well together. What needs to happen to change that culture where it's not perhaps working so well between the multidisciplinary teams?
Yeah, I think we can. We need both, isn't it? We need a top-down and a bottom-up approach to that. And I think the top-down is what we are focused on today. Accountability strategy is what in the gift of this committee, I guess. And then there's a lot bottom-up to think around that sense of ownership, that patient-centered care. For me as a child, profession doesn't end when the child becomes an adult. So I need to own that bit of transition and making it work right through their while they're under my care, but also when they move on, and then keep learning and promoting that sense of a learning culture. I think what gets lost in transition is often that learning culture gets missed. And if we can find a way to help improve that learning culture, that would certainly certainly make a difference, because from my knowledge of anybody who is working with children or adults, they want the best. And what they're limited by is resources and the constraints of their service or their boundaries, or you know how disjointed some of it is. Take it education, take it social work, take it health. I think all of us, the three major agencies, suffer with that. And then if you think of third sector, their commissioning is often a challenge, and when it works, it does wonders, and often resources gets lost, and then all of that is a big gap which is hard to fill by any of the statutory services. So I think there's something about joined up commissioning which is going to make a difference, and I use that word loosely, because I know we are talking about national care services, and my sense is the inception of this bill is a bit happened before the inception of national care services. So there is something to think about. How do we align it to the current thinking, which is what we'll perhaps talk more about today. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that. Can I move on to Nicola Kane now? Would you agree that resources and capacity are the main issue preventing us achieving those good outcomes for our young people? Or what's your reflection?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we know in our COT we've done a survey of our children and young people's staff, and we know that services are struggling just now. 69% of Scottish respondents reported that they're not fully staffed, that they've got increased complexity, increased difficulty. And we know the same can be said across health and social care and our education colleagues as well. And I think everyone feels that they're working in maybe a crisis mode at the moment, and that makes things like transitions and long-term planning take the back foot, and it shouldn't, because long-term, that's how we're going to stop the firefighting and stop crises, intervening early, getting the transition right, and giving the young people the tools for the future to avoid the problems that we're now seeing.
Yeah. Obviously, occupational therapists will work in a variety of environments. Your members will probably be able to give good reflections about how well or otherwise that works. Do you have anything to say on that point about collaboration and coordination to get the best outcome for the young people?
So I think as occupational therapists, we are lucky because we work across education, health, social care, mental health, learning disabilities, acute. We're everywhere, and there's certainly evidence of really good community working. We've had evidence from members and grandparents who talk about their cradle to grave services within the community. It's really effective in that skill mix and avoiding having to pass young people between services when they get to a certain age. But then we also hear the opposite, that's not for the whole country. We know that there, in other areas of the country, people get to 18 and they have to move on. And another member mentioned that within CAMHS, they supported that young person for a long time within community mental health services, and the equivalent adult service was in a hospital. And even that location, that very medical model of being in a hospital, was quite distressing for the young person as they suddenly progressed. So we know that there's not a general way of working across Scotland. It's a very much a postcode lottery. What services happen to be where the priorities lie and where the services lie. And we know in certain areas of the country, our OTs are reporting that they work so well with education, that they've got very close referral links with schools, and they do a lot of their assessments within schools. But again, we know that isn't happening everywhere, and it has to be worked to really to reduce that postcode lottery and make sure there's equitable services across Scotland for our young people.
Thank you. And do your members report back to you what it is that makes things work well when they do work well? You gave the example there of members working well with education.
I think they usually report more on what doesn't make it work well. And I think what comes up quite often is information sharing and IT. I feel like we talk about this till we're blue in the face. But we know that NHS systems use different systems for education, they use different systems for our councils, at times use different systems within primary care. And generally that sharing of information can be quite difficult, and it can mean not just our young people, but service users everywhere are repeating their story, and that is significant when it comes to transition services, where people have been supported by one team their whole life, they then have to retell that story. It's very hard to capture that journey in a short amount of time or within a one-page referral. So I think certainly what comes up often, even after the health and social care integration, being health and social care services, is that sharing of information between IT systems and different IT systems and different priorities between and budgets between services.
I would recognise the challenge between different administrative or IT systems. I think we did also hear, though, from a parent where there was a case meeting for a handover for her young person from Children's Services to Adult Health Services. And despite everyone being in the room, what was agreed and planned didn't continue. So it's probably not always that sort of structural thing about IT. I do understand the challenges around that. I'm keen to bring in Dr. Stark for her reflections on these points.
Thank you. I agree with everything that Nicole and Gandharv have said. I think we know that some transition works very well in healthcare. We've worked very hard in healthcare for single system diseases like diabetes or cystic fibrosis or inflammatory bowel disease. We have very robust transition services. We know a child's going to need transition. We'll have joint transition meetings. There's a nurse involved. Children will be well supported through that transition process, which can take 2 to 3 years. But there's many children who have much more complex needs, who have multiple consultants in the hospital that aren't under a definite ownership of anybody because they're so complex, that are so lost and so complex and are almost abandoned. And these are the children that need to transition most. And these are the children that we're seeing more and more frequently because we're doing so well in our neonatal care where, you know, so many more premature babies are surviving. A lot have got complex needs. So many children are doing well from medical conditions that when I started paediatrics, you would not survive into adulthood. But now children and young people are surviving but have complex needs. And who does the transition and where do they transition to? Often you've got no idea where in adult services, who can you actually engage transition that young person to? We still have children coming to the children's hospital that really should have transitioned many years ago, but there's just nowhere to transition to. We do need to have school nurses. We need to have people who are involved in that transition who can work with the family, find out the family's needs, what's the child's needs, and the child needs to be centred to this. What is that their needs across health, education, social care? Like we heard this morning, what's their opportunities for work? Because there is lots of opportunities out there. Ensuring that each child is allowed to have their human rights and find out the right destination for them and be well supported. And at the moment, we're lost in how to do this. We have not got the resources, and resources come up time and time again. We have not got the resources in secondary care to do this. Our school nurses are getting pulled to other areas, so they are not resourced. And we need people in the community. Third sectors are fundamental for a lot of these families, and their resources getting pulled all the time. So we value this bill, but it needs to be properly resourced. And you know, it would be a good idea to have universal screening of all young people at the age of 14 and find out from them and their families what are their needs, because there's many children with unmet needs, and then they go into this awful period of being maybe 15, and you refer to children's services with a 12-month wait, you wait until they're 16, and then refer to adult services because there's this hiatus of nobody will see you because you're too young or too old. And what happens to that young person who has complex needs and may need transition? And a lot of these young people have got mental health needs as well as physical needs that aren't necessarily being met at the moment.
Thank you. I think that's really helpful, and I think colleagues will want to drill down a little bit more into some of the things you were discussing there. Can I finally ask about, I think Dr. Stark, you potentially covered some of it, but what a successful transition would look like. You spoke about some other some medical conditions where you feel that as a health service it is being done correctly. Could you talk about that a little bit so that we might have a flavour of what it would look like when it's working well?
So I think the successful transition has the child and the family at the heart of it. And they have somebody they can trust that will guide them through the transition process. That's not necessarily a doctor or a nurse. It'll be some professional who understands all the different areas and can communicate with all the different areas that the child and young person may need in the, at the moment and in going into the future, so they can coordinate the care. And the family have got trust in somebody that they can get to know over this transition period, which I feel that should take 2 to 4 years. We need to be, we know that some young children will definitely need transition when they're 10 or 12. We know that's just going to happen. So why not start their transition early, get the idea, get people meeting each other. The process should take 2 to 3 years. It's not a, right, this is it. You come to your birthday and that's you out the door. It needs to be a much more coordinated, and it should be the same across Scotland. We've heard this morning that there's some areas where this works very well, and we need that for all young people. It shouldn't matter where you live in Scotland.
Thank you, that's helpful. Can I come to other panel members, convener?
Of course.
Who would like to come in?
Nicole Keane.
I see both panel members.
Yes. There you go.
Hi. Yeah, I think for us, absolutely, I would echo Dr. Stark was saying there. It's definitely about having that key contact that can support the individual through the process. And really, the key is letting the young person be empowered to guide their own process. It's their transition. What are the goals that they want to achieve? How is it that they want to view their life? And especially having the family involved in making sure they're fully informed of the process. I think more than that, it's thinking more wider than just care needs. It's not just meeting someone's basic needs. It's thinking about employment, it's thinking about leisure, it's thinking about transport. Anything we'd be considering for ourselves, to be honest, that is the bare minimum. We shouldn't be expecting any less for our young people. So success would be our young people being able to fully integrate within society and fully achieve the goals that they set for themselves.
Dr. Joshi? No?
Thank you. I agree with the panel members. And I think what I wanted to add was there's something about empowerment. And I think the transition care plan is an amazing document. But if we had a digital version of it, that would empower families in a way that it would become their own document they carry with them as a story. So this idea of stories not being repeated would become less of an issue if they carried the story with their transition plan on their devices. I think there's something practical, things which would make a difference here. And then there is something about a universal needs assessment that has to happen at something like 14. I think disability increases as people grow older, and we have data for that. I think school leavers was quoted as 8%. I think UK population quotes that at 9%. If you go into adulthood, that becomes 22%. If you think of pensioners, that becomes about 40%. So I think there's something about things change over time, but we need to create a pause point as a culture to stop and think and ask about what are your needs for the future, which will make a difference. And then that passport can carry with them as a thing that's owned by them. So it's not limited by the systems that health, education or social work carries. It's owned by the children and the young people and the parents. And that gets modified as they move forward. Now, this may be fantasy, but on the other hand, there is something which will break. When transitions work well, it is because people come together and the professionals have a relationship. So it does need a headspace to do it well. I think in the current firefighting place, it's really hard to achieve good transitions. So there is, it goes back to resources, it goes back to kind of creating a culture where people are allowed to pause for this.
Thank you. I think we hear quite loudly the importance of culture, and I know that colleagues would also probably understand and appreciate your point there about families not having to tell their story over and over and over again. I think we all know the toll that can take. Thanks, convener.
Thank you very much. Can I move to questions now from Stephen Kerr, please?
Yes, thank you for the evidence you've given us so far, and particularly the succinct way in which you're identifying the potential issues the issues that we are facing in terms of transition. So one of the things that's impressed me in the sessions we've had so far is the relevance of the 7 principles that have were identified by the Scottish Transitions Forum, which I think are hugely relevant. And I've got a very simple question, which is just how successful are these? Is the work of the Transitions Forum proving in terms of improving the transition process? I think I already know what the answer is, but I would like you all to have the opportunity to put on record what your response is to that question, starting with Dr. Joshi.
Thank you. So I think they are the right principles. There's no criticism of the principles. And it's a bit, for me, it's a bit like the Mental Health Act has guiding principles from Milan, and that helps us guide in terms of how we practice. I do wonder if it needs something more like a mental welfare commission, a transition commission, to then make accountability slightly more visible, more independent from service delivery. Because often the service delivery people are limited by resources, but if there is some independence of scrutiny, then that might help embed those principles into working. I think from my own kind of career, I can think transition certainly on people's mind more. So something is working, but in terms of making a difference for everyone, we are not there yet. Condition specific transitions do get better. So I think Dr. Stark mentioned that, you know, that some cancer transitions, some renal condition transition, some cystic fibrosis transition are amazing. And within mental health, what I would say, we do achieve that for certain eating disorder patients in certain areas of Scotland. We achieve that for psychosis. But when it comes to the wider transitions, it becomes really, really focused on the resources. And I think no matter how good the principles are, unless you have the resources, it becomes a shortfall. And that's where I think we with a good intention, we can still don't have an impact that we want it.
So the good thing, Dr. Joshi, is that you're identifying that some of the transitions in some parts of Scotland are very good, but you seem to be saying in general terms they fall victim to culture and resources. And you've raised a very interesting point of an independent commissioner, some kind of independent assessment of how effective transitions are in general. Have I summarised what you've said?
Yeah. No, I did say that. And I think I was more reflecting on today morning's discussion. I think that's not been submitted as a part of my response to the questions. But I think when we think of principles and then the principles affecting culture, that takes a lot of time. So that's where I think something like a commission as a body can help promote that change, because I think legislation might be the right foundation, but we need more than legislation to make a difference on the ground.
You make your point well, and of course the missing element in terms of culture change is always, or the critical element in culture change is always leadership, and you rightly identify that as well. So thank you for that. Nicole Kane, would you like to go next?
Hi, yeah, I think Dr. Joshi's answered that very well. I'd echo the same. No one's going to argue with the principles. They're good principles and absolutely would want to see them in action. And there is evidence of good practices across Scotland, but it's still a postcode lottery. So there is still work to do on the culture and the resources that we've got to realistically achieve the principles, and maybe a little bit more work on training our staff on the principles. I'm not sure how aware everyday staff are around the principles and how much they utilise them in practice, but certainly no one would argue with the value of the principles, and it's the implementation that needs a little bit of work.
So are you suggesting that there's also a capability gap when it comes to the implementation?
I think in terms of resources and in terms of staff's ability to take on more information and more workload, certainly we imagine with this bill it will increase workload as we identify how many people are being missed in the transitions.
So it's capacity and capability that you're identifying, yes?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Very clear. Dr. Stark, would you like to comment?
We agree with the principles as well, and we have lots of good resources on our website of examples of good transition. Mm-hmm. And Elderhay have got a 10-step programme on how transition can be done, but it all revolves around the people on the ground having enough time and resources and people who can really interact with the family and find out what their needs are and where they would like to progress things. At the moment, we just don't have that. Without that, I think it's very difficult to put anything further forward. And we know this is going to be an increasing need. It's not going away. We know that there's more and more children with complex health needs and mental health needs every year. We're seeing an explosion in these areas in adolescence at the moment. So it's an increasing issue that will need increasing resources going forward if we're going to manage it well.
So I've got a colleague who I'm sure is going to ask about the difference that any further legislation, any statute will make, but you're identifying issues that actually, I think, fairly to say, are pretty immune to statute, things like resources, culture, capability and capacity, capacity being related, of course, to resources. So, Dr. Joshi, you mentioned specifically health-focused transition plans and how effective they are in your answer to me earlier. Can I ask you to comment more broadly on how effective health-focused transition plans are, particularly, for example, in relation to CAMHS transition care plans? He's muted.
That's you now.
Thank you. So in terms of how the healthcare transition plan are working, it is variable in terms of how well it works. I think that I've got examples where it works fantastically, and then I have examples where it feels like, gosh, this we've got this, but it falls apart. And then there are examples that it goes terribly wrong. So I think there is a whole spectrum of it. Like I was saying earlier, we don't put enough time in learning from it. And maybe that's where we need to put some emphasis on how do we learn from it going well, but also from not going well, as we do for other adverse events. And then what makes it work? I think what's been said is very clear. It's people on the ground that makes it work. And when families have a clarity on what they need, it's also another big variable of what makes it work. Often families need changes, and then that makes it really hard when we have anticipated something, and that's not going to, there's going to be a mismatch of that. So then everybody has to be very creative in how fast they adapt to those changing needs. And that can be quite challenging, particularly when you think of different services. You know, the culture between children's service and adult services is a very different emphasis on who is our client. There's also a big change in emphasis on who is the driver of change. So the agency often changes from parents to adults in some way, which is, I think, very appropriate. Society wants that, but it adds an extra layer of challenge when there is so much wrap around for children's services versus adult services having less wrap around. So in short, to answer your question, there are very good examples of it working, and I think when it works, it goes back to the seven principles. So that's the crux of it. Yeah.
I mean, so you commented there, and I'd just like you to maybe expand on this if you could. You talked about the lack of learning culture that you've witnessed. Can you just expand on that? Maybe describe more what you mean when you say that.
I think what I mean is, I'll give an example. So when I think of transition, I think of inpatient, outpatient transitions for my patients who go into a young people's unit and they come out. So after a discharge, after 6 weeks, 8 weeks, sometimes we meet again. We make a point to meet again so that we can learn from that admission. So that helps us pause and think and then influence what could we have done better. I don't see that happening with the transitions that I do between children and adult services. I think if we can promote that as a practice, then there is a much more scope of that sense of joint ownership. What could have I done to make it work better? Because yeah. Nobody wants it to fall apart. No, that's where I'm coming from. Yeah.
Yeah, very useful in terms of work practice and a cultural insight as well. And can I ask the same original question, back to my original question, can I ask Nicole Kane to comment, please?
Yeah, similarly, we've got very good examples of health-led transitions, but there are also challenges. I think our members report a lack of structure and guidance in the planning of transitions. And I think that comes back to that learning culture. You know, are we giving our staff the time to learn about the seven principles, to consider their services, to redesign? Are we giving them that CPD time to continuously develop and work and build connections with other services well? So I think there's evidence of good, but as we know, that isn't across the board.
So, I mean, are you saying, I mean, I don't want to be guilty of putting words in your mouth or taking an interpretation of what you said, but when you talk about learning culture, when you were expanding on the comments earlier from Dr. Joshi, are you satisfied that the young person is actually at the centre of this process? Or are there things happening around the individual which the individual is really not connected to?
I think our practitioners certainly aim to have the young person and their family at the heart of the service, but that isn't, they're not always working within an ideal situation. They are at the mercy of available resources and available services. But members saying, you know, there's a lack of facilities or like-for-like services we can refer on to. So as much as we would like to keep the person at the centre, that can be challenging within day-to-day practice.
That can be challenging for the people concerned, but must be terribly frustrating for the professionals that are working within such constraints.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Dr. Stark, your comments.
I agree. It's very difficult because we all want the child and the family at the centre, but sometimes you have to just see what resources there are available and fit things around that. We're not able to do things as we ideally want to do things. And often it's if it's a medical transition, it's one consultant who's doing the transition, who's seeing them the most. It may not be the most appropriate clinician for the family, but it's the one that has stuck their hand up and agreed to do it. There's no time or resources for anybody to do this. It's enormously time consuming. So we need separate individuals that can coordinate this care, because too much has been put on people who are already overstretched, and you cannot do this well unless it's resourced.
And how critical is it that someone is responsible for the organising the transition across different agencies and services for that one individual who should be at the centre of it all, and their families?
It's very important for that individual, because they need to know who it is, they need to have input, and if you haven't got a named individual doing it, it just may not happen. And then people are lost to services. And we know that young people with complex needs have got poorer outcomes in the longer term. And some of that could be mitigated by having really good, robust transitions. But somebody needs to take ownership of that transition with the family so that it can actually be successful.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes that success, we heard on Monday, one parent said that the successful outcome they were describing for their child was because of the family, and it was in spite of everything that had happened around them. Would that be a fairly common response that a parent might have?
It is a common response, and often you find that some of these families, they have very articulate parents who are able to fight for their child and ensure that they get a lot for and what they need, and their transition will be successful. But there's many families out there who don't have that support. Their families are not able to support them in that way. They haven't got the abilities themselves to do it. They may have learning difficulties themselves. And how is that family supposed to navigate our difficult system, which is not there to help you, when you haven't got somebody by your side who is your advocate supporting you for the best transition that you can have? Because, you know, ideally, we'd all like to have two supportive parents by our sides going through all transitions in life for all families, but that doesn't always happen. So we need to ensure that these children are not disadvantaged because they haven't got a family member who will be their advocate and speak up. All children deserve good transition and to have good life outcomes.
I'd say that, Dr. Stark, that was the sense I had listening to the parents, because the parents we were talking to were absolutely articulate. They were campaigning. They were committed in and had the wherewithal, as it were, in terms of their ability to articulate, to advocate. And that did occur to me what would happen to the many who did not have the benefit of that support. That's the conclusion of my questions.
Thank you, Stephen. I would like to follow up on, again, from stuff that we heard on Monday evening, and it's a specific transition issue where, Dr. Stark, you mentioned there about the level of intensity and expertise that's in your paediatric services, but when the young person transitions on to the adult services, they're on a bit of a catch-up, or indeed you don't know where to go. And we heard specifically about audiology and how a young person had the latest technology in terms of their hearing aids and all the systems. And then when they went to adult services, though that young person was having to train the professional on how to use them. Do you get a sense that that is replicated across the country? And is it just audiology, or is that in other services? Dr. Stark. And maybe
I think
Nicole, actually.
It's probably in many services, and certainly many families are very resistant to transition to adult services because they feel that they'll get not such a good service. I've not worked in adult services for 25 years, but very much in paediatrics, we often have a consultant delivered service. Consultants in paediatrics are working well beyond their hours because we put the child and the family at the centre of it. It's not just a number on the waiting list. So it's really difficult for us. We feel a bit paternalistic, which we shouldn't do. But, you know, ensuring that everybody has the right services moving on, and that's particularly for areas where there may not be a service to move on to, or for children who were just finding out they've got ASD or other issues, and we're not sure where we're going to get them the help and support in a timely fashion before it's time to move on to adult services.
OK. We'll move on unless anyone else wants to respond to that. There's nothing in the chat function. So can I move now to questions from Stephanie Callaghan, please? Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener. I'm going to go back to you again, Dr. Stark. You're getting a few questions just now. You spoke earlier on about there being some really good examples of successful transition plans. So can you tell me a bit more about some of those successes and how the balance worked between practical needs and individual aspirations?
And for example, diabetes, where we're having joint clinics. But there are some areas where we have exceptional learning disability nurses and community nurses who have been able to work with individual families, and some individual families with the right workers involved and AHPs and everybody talking together will have good success. But it very much falls on individuals, and we don't have enough of those individuals, and some of the children aren't even identified. So that's why I worry about some people who, you know, they may have, I've had children in my clinic who they've not been known to have a learning disability because they don't cause trouble in school. So I've picked it up by asking them specific questions. And then, you know, when I've spoken to the family, they're like, well, the school didn't do anything before because we didn't push it. And the parent had a difficulty themselves, so they weren't able to enact it. But I've got in touch with the senior school and spoken to the pastoral teachers and said, look, I've been asked to be this child's advocate. This is all in my own time. This is all relying on individuals doing work that's not in their remit. We need people who are doing jobs that encompass all of this in all areas, because otherwise it's too much of a hit or miss. It's a postcode lottery of, do you get the right individual who will help you through the process? And there are some exceptional individuals out there who are doing the work, and those families have got a good transition process, but it's too hit and miss.
So just to pick up on that, really, before I move on to anybody else, I'm quite happy for others to come in on that there, then certainly that's something that we have been hearing quite a lot from the families, from young people themselves, that it is all about individuals that really step up and make that difference in their lives. And we've heard earlier on in today's evidence as well about, what is it they call it, about mandated, dedicated transition workers working with young people. I'm wondering if that's something that you feel could make that difference, someone who could be that person. Because I think the question is, you know, we've spoken about named individuals today as well, but who are those individuals to take that ownership and accountability?
Do you want...
Sorry,
Dr. Stark, you carry on.
I think you do need an individual, and the individual needs to be the right individual for the right, for that child and the family. So depending on what the issue is, if you have a mental health condition, it may actually be your CAMHS key worker. If you have a complex learning disability, it may be more social work, or it may be a completely different worker. If you have a medical condition like cystic fibrosis, it'll be much more of a medical model. So it needs to be the right person for the right family. But I think every family, every child needs somebody who is dedicated for their transition process, and that the family know who that person is and they have some say on who they feel would be the best individual to support them through the process of transition.
Okay.
Joshi, would you like to come in now, please?
Yeah, I think transition champions is what our membership used as a word, you know, that sense of, you know, people who can champion transition and see that as their role. I think for it to work well, they need to be owned in between services rather than belong to one service, which I think is often the challenge if you think about why is transition an issue. In one of the examples I have in my mind when transition does work well is, you know, because in Scotland, children's services finish at 16 social work-wise, we have to do a transition of social worker for our mental health patients. And then when they're 18, we do a health transition. So naturally, their social worker who is based in adult team becomes their transition object or their transition champion by default. And I guess that's what I'm thinking when I think, what does make it work? I think it's about somebody holding their hand through that change. And sometimes, like Dr. Stark said, it needs to be appropriate to their needs. You know, it could be somebody in third sector, it could be somebody within strategy services, but it needs someone who has that foot in both camps. So then they have got the connections which will make the difference.
So just going back to something that you said earlier then, Doctor, I certainly don't disagree with that. You spoke about individuals should be able to carry their own documents, that's their story, and have ownership over that. And also about the flexibility to change is really a factor as well. So I'm wondering as well, do you see a transition plan almost as being kind of more part of a longer-term kind of shared health and social care plan, a transition plan that kind of fits in and is part of that rather than being something quite separate to what's happening? And I'd be interested in how the others felt about that as well. Thanks.
I would certainly agree to that. I think there's something about, as soon as I think about realistic medicine, and I think what we sometimes become a bit paternalistic about is our records, and then the records can't talk to others' records. But if our young people and parents can hold those records as their own stories, then we are cutting across that barrier very quickly, and then helping empowering them with their stories, and that those stories are expected to be to be shared and learned by anybody trying to help. And just I wanted to comment on the previous question. I think if we truly believe that people are expert by their lived experience, then we should allow people to know more about their audiology equipment than the professionals. And I think there is something about that, isn't that if somebody is an expert by experience, then they will know more about what they use and what they have than the professional who's in front of them. And I think we should just accept that.
Thank you. I don't know if anybody else wants to know.
Can we move now to some questions from Graham Day, please? Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning to the witnesses. This bill, if nothing else, has brought all of these issues into sharp focus, and I think that's been hugely important. But I guess my question is it the answer? Because, for example, there are criticism of the draft legislation that it replicates existing duties. And aren't we really in danger here, potentially, that we simply further congest the landscape, when actually what we need to do is to make real change? And if we accept that premise, potentially, if we didn't have the legislation in front of us, could we go about fixing these problems effectively? And if we could, what would be the priorities?
Not to.
Sorry, to Dr. Stark to start with.
I think that's an interesting question. I think for me, the resources are more important than the bill. I think the professionals around the child all want the best for the child and the transition, but they need the resources and abilities to do this transition well. So yes, the bill brings it into focus of Scottish Government that we need to do this, and it, you know, actually we could do this without the bill, but if the bill means it will then get resources and funded and will happen, then the bill has a place.
So I accept that argument to an extent, but with respect, the NHS and other entities will always say, if you give us more money, we can fix this. Isn't there also, from what we've heard today, right across the session, some cultural and systemic problems that need to be addressed out with purely financial resource and what flows from that?
I think we need to get the adult services on board. I think a lot of this ends up on the hands of the paediatric services who are looking after the young child. They feel all the responsibility, whereas who you're passing them on to doesn't feel that because they aren't theirs. You know, and the resources often go to adults. Adults vote, so adults get resources. You know, we increase the age limit for young people coming to the children's hospital and COVID times, but the money didn't flow. You know, so we need to make sure that
that the money follows the patient, essentially.
Yeah. Or just that there is that some things are resourced more readily than others, because it's much more easy. It's much easier to see how many older women and men are waiting on the hip replacement list. You can see that. It's a black and white figure. Okay. For children with complex disabilities who are needing third sector support, it's very grey. There's no... And children waiting on general paediatric waiting lists or on CAMHS waiting lists, it's just not the same impetus as being on a hip or knee waiting list, which is a very black and white waiting list. So we need to put children back into the centre. These are our assets. You know, children, young people are what we need to have a good future in Scotland. They will be our workers of the future. These young people often want to work. They have got great abilities to work, but they're not being allowed to fulfil their potential. And we need the potential. It's not about what happens in the next parliament or the next 5 years. It's what happens to these young people over the next 30, 50 years when we frankly won't be around. So it's investing in our young people, which often gets missed because we're not going to see that within the next parliament. We're talking about improvements that we will see in 20 or 30 years.
Okay, thank you for that. That's a really useful answer. And Dr. Joshi?
Yeah. So I think I do think there's something duplication in this bill For example, if GERFEC works well, the team around the child can be expected to manage this, to be doing it well, if it's well-resourced. I think that's where the resources come into it. I think the leadership is at the heart of it. I think what is lacking is a bit of leadership. I think that's if that can be influenced, then things can shift. And I don't want to criticize the committee, and I think that there might be more evidence that you gather after this, but it's interesting that we don't have an adult colleague as a part of your panel to speaking about this transition bill. And that's striking, isn't it? That I'm a child professional, Dr. Stark is a child professional. And there is something for me about the ownership of this lies. How do you bridge that child and adult services in some way for it to work well? Often, and this is a criticism I hear from my adult colleagues, right, left, and center, I hear that I spoiled my patients. and I think there's something about the culture in adult services is that we do it right, the rest of the world do it wrong. while the sitting in the children's services, I would think we do it right because this is important. You know, unless we help people into some form of productivity, they are going to be a burden on the nation, and that's not their choice. You know, we are not giving them an opportunity to not be a burden on the nation, and that's where the investment in child and the money following the child is what would be quite a good outcome. Not fighting between services in some way.
Okay. Thank you, that's useful. And Nicole Kane.
The Royal College of Occupational Therapists support the bill in terms of it bringing in that accountability and someone being accountable. It also gives us the opportunity to eradicate that postcode lottery by having a set of standards that's across Scotland and can have that equitable service for our children. However, you're quite right, in the bill itself won't result in change. That's, we need to look at it at cultural level. Dr. Stark's completely right, and our staff are burnt out and our staff are under-resourced. We know the occupational therapists, for example, have 3 times the level of vacancies we did pre-pandemic. There is a need for investment in the workforce, because without the workforce and the resource, with the best will of the world, the bill isn't going to achieve anything. I think we also need to consider where children and young peoples are going to sit. We know there's a lot of change going on around the National Care Service at the moment, some other legislation that will be going alongside this, and that wider, more population level approach we'll need to consider.
Okay, thank you. Do you want to ask my other question? Thanks, Convener. I'm moving on then slightly, and thank you all for your answers. Would a national transition strategy, if it was based upon the best practice that we have seen, because we know that there are some parts in the country where things work well, if we had that, would it lead to a more consistent approach and far better outcomes?
First. Will we go to Nicole first on this one?
Yeah, I'm not sure I've got an answer. First of all, I'm trying to think of that one. Certainly, yeah, we know there's good practice going on, and I think there needs to be that sharing of good practice. So highlighting what is working, where it's working, and why it's working. I'm not sure that's entirely clear at the moment. We get that anecdotal evidence from our members going, we're doing really well here, or anecdotal evidence elsewhere, but we're not doing so well here. So yeah, definitely that information exchange, why is it working well, where is it working well, and how do we replicate that across the country, then yeah, I think that would result in better outcomes for our young people.
Do you think, perhaps an unfair question, I'm going to ask it anyway, do you think that professionals are always entirely receptive to suggestions of best practice elsewhere? Because by implication, it criticises what they're doing.
I think our workforce should always have a culture of continuously development, and I'm sure they would tell you that they do have a culture of continuous development and they're open to that. However, I think people are feeling strains at the moment, and more change can bring a lot of stress, even if it's for the better. And we've got a burnt out workforce, so implementing that change can be challenging if they're not on board. And that's just respecting where that service is at the moment and what our workforce has been through over the last 3 years. Our workforce should absolutely be open to fair criticism or critique. Yeah.
So I guess, not trying to put words in your mouth, but for this bill to work, it would have to be accompanied by resources, but it would also have to, however it finished up, convince the workforce that it was going to make a tangible difference.
Absolutely, yeah, and I think you can't, you're not going to enact any change without that co-production, without staff believing in what they're not going to engage in it if they don't think it's going to result in better outcomes for the population or the young people they're working with. So yeah, you absolutely need the workforce on board.
Yeah. Okay. Dr. Joshi, do you want to come in on this?
I've not got much more to add besides I think it makes for it to work, absolutely, we need the bottom-upness to it, alongside the top-down intention. For me, a lot of what is in this bill sits within GERFEC as a practice, as a culture, and it would be useful if there was a way to simplify by reinforcing it, rather than adding a layer of another legislation, because then there's community support plans, and then there's also the kind of within mental health there's something called care program approach, which is what often the for the most complex patients the GERFEC changes into a CPA when it comes to transitions, and that's good practice. You know, when it happens like that, that's when you see it is working, because CPA brings all the agencies together and helps to have a shared ownership with patient at the heart of implementing those changes. So I think, do we need a legislation? I think I'm not 100% sure. Do we do? But if there was a way to do what the intention is without legislation, I think that would be a better outcome. Because it keeps the world a bit clearer. Because the more legislation often adds more red tape in some way sometimes. Yeah.
Thanks. And finally, Dr. Stark.
I think as healthcare professionals, we actually embrace quality improvement. We're always looking at ways to improve what we're doing and thinking of different ways. And you know, COVID was a great example of how we've changed what we do. We now use things like Near Me that we'd never thought of before. And you know, we embrace change. We do change all the time. It's part of our nature. We're looking to improve. What I would want is, as Joshi said, getting the adult professionals involved. Whenever we have meetings for transition, even in our local area, we set up meetings, and invariably the adult side send their apologies. So we need, people need time to do this. They need to see the importance of doing this. And that can't happen without actually giving people the headspace to do quality improvement. You can't just do quality improvement in all your holidays and weekends. It's just not feasible on an exhausted workforce. But we do want change. We're open to change, but it's difficult when you're just firefighting on a daily basis.
OK, thank you. We hear you. Thank you.
That's great, and that sort of reflects some of the comments we heard earlier on in the session as well around long-term change and firefighting. I think that was Nicole that referenced that. We have the bill, and that's why we're here today, is to look at, and we're in our stage one element of the transitions bill. But if you were to look, well, you obviously have looked at it, so considering that, could you perhaps expand on any aspects of the bill that you think might or should change? If you were to have the opportunity to do that, can I go to Dr. Joshi first, please?
Thank you. I think for me, when I first read the bill, it was very hard for me to know what was described as disability. So then I tried to use my logic to try and think it must be the Disability Act. But I think if there's something to change, it's good to define that disability slightly, or reference to that bill to then it becomes clearer that who which is the population we are focusing on. And certainly our membership had that confusion around, you know, is this, because that would apply to all mental health patients in some way, you know, who have had more than 12 months of suffering or impairment in that sense. And then it becomes easier to focus on the next bit of the bill, which is about how do we make transitions better. I guess the other bit for the bill is about it talks about healthcare So the IJBs and the health support partnerships and it's, to me, it feels like it's such a changing world out there that we need to update it to make it current to a kind of the current scenario, you know, particularly the National Care Service bit needs to be added into it to make it more congruent to our current place of thinking of where we are. And I do wonder around if we had the same budget in charge who looked after education, social work, health, and then also the adult services, there'll be less of this kind of a cliff effect. Often parents talk about the cliff effect, that I had these resources and that was pulled because the assessment of the new team said that's not there in our gift. But if it was the same purse, then there's more likelihood of the child assessment of need being respected and followed through for as long as it is needed, rather than a reassessment of needs, which is often when things become disjointed or a conflict or a dispute starts. And I really like the dispute section because I think it's useful to know from a law point of view who has the final say in this, because disability for me is becoming more and more of a subjective experience than an objective experience. So if we are, as a society, moving into calling disability a subjective experience, then that needs to be what the legislation reflects on.
I think there'll be some questions on that, perhaps, from my colleague in a moment, in terms of drilling down on that. I'm looking to him to catch his eye. Dr. Stark, do you have any comments on what aspects may or may not change in the bill? If you don't, then we can move on to ask Nicole and then over to you.
I've not got any specific comments on that, but I think it is worth the committee really thinking what difference will this bill actually make in practice. And, you know, but from my point of view, it's been enormously helpful having this bill being brought up, because it's making us all think about what makes transition better for children.
That's a very pointed comment in itself, Dr. Stark, so thank you, very helpful. Nicole, do you want to add anything to that, or will we move?
Yep, just a brief point. Yeah, is what I think I'd echo Dr. Josh's call for more detail on who this bill's encompassing. We know that children with learning difficulties, physical disabilities and mental health issues all face transitional challenges, so a bit more detail there, and on to exactly who's going to be accountable to make sure this happens and how that's going to look. So how are we going to improve access to care, access to resources, access to rehabilitation, which we know is key to a good transition. And I would also put out the call for making sure there's co-production and having our workforce, both children and adults, being involved in that process.
Thank you very much, Nicole. Can I move now to questions from my colleague Bob Dorris, please?
Good morning, everyone. Can I thank the convener for a seamless transition onto the next line of questions? So there's been a bit of chat about whether legislation is or isn't needed, but we're scrutinising the legislation which is before us. And I'm very conscious there are lots of things out there already. So in 2004, there's ASN obligations and local authorities for plans put in place for children. Where other agencies are involved, those there should be coordinated support plans put in place. In 2018, there was transition care plans put in place for young people from CAMHS into adult services. So there's a lot of things out there. But this legislation before us will put an obligation on local authorities to identify children and young people eligible for a transition plan. How do you think they should do that? Because the EHRC's submission said that there was greater clarity needed in relation to that. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are in relation to that. And only because I can see Dr. Joshi nodding his head, we'll perhaps take him first.
Thank you. Maybe I got a tick and I just keep nodding. I'm not doing that. I think I would agree with that comment that it needs details to understand that, because I think there's something about a bit of a public health approach that is what I see in it, that if a local authority has an obligation to find out who needs transition, then there needs to be something universal, that kind of a needs assessment done at certain age group and then followed it through, which is a way to identify in a universal way. Now, universal screening works for certain, when there is a certain level of prevalence And as soon as that prevalence drops below a critical number, universal screening becomes unhelpful because you start to get a lot of false positives. So I think we need to keep that statistics in our mind to try and think, is that possible? And maybe that's a coping exercise to do around disability. Is universal screening a useful tool at certain age to then follow that through as a part of anticipating transitions? And for me, there's also something about, you're absolutely right, there are legislations out there which enforce it in different agencies or locates it within education, within social work, within health. But if there is something to give a joined upness to it, then that's a bit sometimes lacking as a part of, like I say, for me, GERFEC is the answer to all of it because that has got the clout. But often it lacks the resources or the lacks the services that people can transition into.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Stark. Do you want to perhaps make a reflection on my question?
I think there's two things. One is whether if you have it down to local authorities, will there be postcode lottery again, or are we going to have the same system across all local authorities? And if things are devolved to local authorities, which I think in some ways is very sensible because that's where education, social work all fits, that the resources need to follow this. We can't just say in central government, oh, this is a great idea, and it's something that the local authorities have to suddenly find more money for. It needs to be resourced because otherwise it's just saying this is a great idea, but then leaving people to postcode lottery because many local authorities are going to be struggling to implement any more than they are at the moment.
Okay, thank you. And I think the resources have been a recurring theme. I won't take up the cudgels on that simply because I've got a specific line of questioning, but I did want to acknowledge the comments you made there, Nicole Kane.
Yep, certainly. So I think local authorities are well positioned in terms of their proximity to education and social care. But within that, we then get the issue with postcode lottery and also how well they collaborate with their local NHS services. We know certain mental health services and at times learning disability services are very NHS led, and we want to make sure people don't fall through the cracks there if it's something that they've not had to access being a local authority before. I think certainly let the local authorities allow for a personalised approach, knowledge of what's in their community, what services they can access. But in terms of how we identify who's eligible for that, I think that really needs to come down to the individuals themselves and the key worker they're working with. I would avoid any crude criteria, and we know people don't fit nicely into boxes. I think our professionals that are working with them and the individuals themselves will be able to identify if they've got ongoing needs that they're going to need to access adult services or ongoing goals that they're going to need support with.
Okay. Nicole Kane, I think that's helpful because I was going to follow and talk about eligibility a little bit. I was going to ask about the definition for eligibility within the legislation before us, which is based on the Equality Act definition of disability. So I'm just wondering, in the first instance, whether you thought that was an appropriate definition. But, of course, having a clear definition out there is open to interpretation for who qualifies under that definition. Yeah. Simply having the definition in itself doesn't give you allow you to trawl through data or individual circumstances at a local level and work out who does qualify. So I'm just wondering whether you think that's the correct definition. Also, given what we've heard earlier, I think it was from Dr. Stark about a young person not known to any service who was demonstrating, I think, was it behavioural issues? There was learning disability issues that had been undiagnosed, I think. There were a lot of young people not known to service. How do we address that? Dare I say, please don't go off on this tangent, but just say yes or no in relation to this bit. Does the National Care Service have something to play in this? Because Nicole Kane spoke about a postcode lottery. So is the eligibility criteria sufficient? How do we interpret that? And how do we make sure there's not a postcode lottery? Sorry for throwing all those three things in, Convener. I can see the glower. Dr. Stark, do you want to go first, perhaps?
I think the disability is difficult. At the moment, we know there's some very straightforward children who've got complex needs and clearly eligible that we're not getting things right for. So I think we need to get things right for these children, and then we need to expand what we're doing to include the children who at the moment are a bit lost. And it needs we need to be putting this on children and their families of, do you feel you have a need? Is there a possible need? If there is a need, you speak to your pastoral teachers or somebody else who can then refer you to the further system. But for children who've got complex difficulties, these are clear children who need to have complex transition with a transition worker. We're not even getting them right at the moment. So I think debating on the small technicalities is maybe not where we should be today.
That's very helpful. It brings back to resources, but I won't go there. Nicole Kane, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, certainly. It's difficult how we're going to address the postcode lottery. We hope that this bill would bring in a national set of guidance that each local authority has to meet, but obviously resources, without going into it again, does differ between local authorities. The National Care Service is likely to impact this work because we don't know where children and young people are going to sit yet. We know some services work within the NHS, some are positioned within social care, and some are positioned within education. So without going into too much detail, it'll be interesting to see where that goes and how it'll impact services. In terms of eligibility, we've got examples as well of young people with additional support needs, but not behavioural needs, who are missed in schools, maybe because they aren't as noticeable. And we know that there are occupational therapists across Scotland doing some work with teachers and education providers to identify those children, but they are still being missed. In terms of eligibility, I would not move away from a medical model, the need for a diagnosis, and base solely on care needs and support education providers, third sector and health and social care to identify those people.
Dr. Joshi, just before I bring you in, because the convener will like this, it will help with time, I'm going to mention resources now. Perhaps you could refer to that as part of your answer. Also, I think Dr. Stark made a really good point about we're not getting it right for all the people that are on our radar and in the system currently, and that whilst eligibility criteria is important to identify those who are not getting the service they should get, those are double resource implications. There's a resource implication to meet the needs of those young people we already know about, and other young people who may have, there's a spectrum of needs out there, isn't there, who may have more mild, but for that family, quite profound and important needs for them, and that brings additional resource allocations. So the only part of the bill that is looking at resource is the financial memorandum that estimates 4,000 school leavers needing to go through this transitions process each year. So I'm just wondering, in relation to resources, is that an appropriate way to measure resource in the context of this legislation, and whether or not there could be a tension within resources about getting it right for young people already on the radar needing good quality service and transition, and other young people that as yet we don't know about. Again, I apologise to the convener, lots of questions in there. Dr. Joshi, could you come in there, please?
I try my best. So I guess from when we asked our membership around this, you know, what is the kind of the first priority? And I think naturally they said the one that we know, we need to focus on that first. But what we do about the ones that we don't know, and I think that's where it becomes really complex, because I think the example which was quoted for us was fetal alcohol syndrome. You know, often they don't neatly fit into any boxes. They often don't have a learning disability. They might not even have a behavioral difficulty which is diagnosable, but their needs are striking for them to succeed in life, and there's resource implications to that. So I think that there is something about National Care Services as a concept has a lot of potential, but I think we need to add some details to that, something like MCNs for specific conditions, in a way that it makes a difference nationally and decreases the postcode lotteries. Because there is something about if we have a network of professionals who can support the areas which have not got those professionals, I'm thinking of islands particularly, then that's where the difference can start, by bringing the Scottish expertise available, accessible to the wider area. Now, in terms of where do we start? So there's those 4,000 as a number, for me, sounds like an underestimate. I think if the one of the principles we need to do is to start early. So if we start early, I'm sure that number won't be 4,000 in terms of people who have children who have disability, and then some of them might, their disability might change by the time they are at a transition age, because things do change, and some of it gets added, some of it gets taken away, but it would be useful to go a bit beyond before the age of transition to try and find out the volume of who classes themselves as disabled.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Joshi. Dr. Stark.
I think, again, that's probably an underestimate of the number of children we're thinking about. And we do know that number is increasing all the time because of children having more complex needs, doing well from medical conditions that they previously wouldn't have done, and now surviving, but with needs, and particularly prematurity. We're seeing more and more children who are surviving from much earlier gestational age, which will give us more young people who will need to transfer in the future. So that transition process will only increase, and I think we need to keep that in mind, that there isn't this X amount of young people at the moment. It's an increasing pot, and we really need to be putting those young people at the centre. I think it's very difficult at the moment because we're probably going to be missing some of the young people. The school nurses, their role has changed. So there isn't necessarily somebody in school who will be able to identify them maybe as easily as previous. And we need to ensure that we have the right mechanisms in schools that we can identify anybody that may be needing some help with transition.
Thank you very much. And finally, Nicole Kane.
Yeah, similarly, I think what we're seeing at RCOT and the work we're doing, we know that there's an increase in demand, we know there's an increase in complexity, and we know that we're still missing people. So the 4,000 probably is a conservative number. We're probably going to see more of that, and we're going to see it continuously increasing. And that's why I would probably echo Dr. Joshi's ask to move that earlier. We're moving earlier and not waiting until school leave, but intervening as early as possible to give our young people the tools to manage their own transition and to make sure that their needs are considered well beforehand.
OK, thank you. Thank you,
thank you very much, Ms. Doris. Can we move to questions now from Willie Rennie, please?
I mean, whatever the merits or demerits of this bill, what it has done is brought a focus to the issues, and that in itself is a helpful thing. I'm struck by my encounters with constituents and organisations where they're able to communicate to me, parents who are experts at championing the rights of their children, and often they do that into quite later life, but they are brilliant at it and ferocious as well. And we need to draw on more of their talents. But I'm also struck by employers and organisations that I meet that are frustrated that other employers don't understand the full potential of this untapped resource. And this is looking at, rather than a burden, this is looking at it as an opportunity for employers, but also the young people and older people, because many of them live into quite old age. So we need to consider their lifelong opportunities. Do you think employers fully understand the potential? And if not, what do you think we can do to persuade them to understand the full potential? Whoever would like to contribute, I'll let you pick.
Nicole looks like she's going towards the button.
Within occupational therapy, we do a lot of work within vocational rehabilitation, supporting people into employment. However, we know that a lot of the time the focus has been on what skills can we give the individual to become employable, rather than maybe working with the employer for them to see the value in hiring someone that they maybe wouldn't have previously. We know there's really good opportunities going on, like Project Search, that work with NHS Scotland
and local authorities in supporting young people with additional support needs and autism into workplaces, and they've seen great success across the UK. But I think there is still a lot of work to be done there. I think employment should be a key focus. We know it gives people a sense of purpose. We know it gives people, allows them to be fully productive in society and feel as a full member of society. So it's a really important area to look at going forward.
Anybody else?
I mean, I think what you highlight is what's the missing link at present. I think the adult educational provision is not as adaptable as what we find schools are. And I think if this legislation can help that, then that would be a wonderful outcome to make them a bit more accountable for those adaptations, just the way the schools are accountable for the adaptations that they need to make to succeed the children. I don't think the adult educational system has got the same bit of focus on doing that. And I think then translating that into the work culture, there is also another missing bridge of some sort, because I certainly think my adult colleagues complain of this all the time, that they don't have the same influence that we have as a mental health professional on schools. They don't have the same influence in the workplace. And there is a lot of limitations to when even the best recommendations can completely be ignored, because the whole attitude is very different to as compared to say something that happens in the school versus the adult educational or the employment place. There is a huge untapped potential. I think people with disability bring so much skills, and I think that they often don't get valued for it, and then of course that creates a burden in a kind of a public health way. So thank you.
Okay, that's fine.
Dr. Stark wants to come in.
It's just I've said it many times, but I think we need to be looking at young people as our assets for the future. And we all want to live in an inclusive society. And we know that if you're doing work of any sort, whether that's voluntary or paid work, you feel much better. And well-being and health is much better if you're in employment. So trying to work with employers, to incentivize employers, and to show people that actually they can get a lot of positives from working with young people who may have disabilities but have lots of other skills that will really bring to the workplace is really important. So I think we just need to change our mindset that these young people are not a burden that need looked after, but they are assets that need to reach. All young people have the right to have their full potential and to meet all what they would like to do in life. And I think it's just a change of mindset that we're just not there at the moment.
Thank you very much for that. And what a positive way to finish the meeting, talking about our young people being a real asset to society. Yes. And everyone that we've heard from today has been determined to get it right for every child and young person that they are working with. And I'd like to thank everybody for such powerful evidence, and indeed thank you for your time this morning. And that's the public part of today's meeting at an end, so thank you very much.